I think we have so much to talk about, but I gotta ask you,
Yeah.
what is up with the drama lately? Why is everyone going crazy? Is everyone on their period? What is going on?
Maybe Mercury's in retrograde. I'm ovulating currently,
Oh,
so maybe
congratulations.
that's it.
Are you gonna use that to your advantage?
No, I'm avoiding it. But yeah, I don't. I have no idea. There's something in the water. Well, here's what I don't know how petty I want to be. I think I won't choose violence today, actually. I'm
Tell
just
me.
gonna. I think that I think that Oh. Maybe everyone is on their period. It seems to this there's a lot of feminine energy in the drama. There's a lot of women who are involved in the drama.
I've noticed. And I've
So
noticed you picking fights with everybody, girl. What's up with that?
I absolutely picked a fight with Cherry, proudly. I
Is
will
it
pick fights with
Sherry or
Cherry.
Cherry?
Cherry, I
Cherry.
think. I actually don't know.
Oh, God.
That's how important she is to me. I don't even know.
Okay. So, why do you think it is, though? What do you think is happening genuinely from your perspective? Do you feel like you're just really trying to find yourself and people aren't understanding you? What do you think it is?
I think I'm a very flawed person, and I think I am like pretty wishy-washy, and I'm also very anxious.
Sure.
So, I think when pressed on a point, especially when Steven wants me to give like a hard answer on something, because that's the sphere that you're in, where it's like debate, bro, you have to have your position, you have to fight for it.
Yeah.
I'm just like, that's not my thing. I'm
Yeah.
more interested in like a Bohmian dialogue where I'm like, where I want to tell you how I feel, you can tell me how you feel, we see where we converge, you give me new information, maybe I give you new information. Like, that's way more my speed than like arguing in. And then when I'm forced to give prescriptions, they're like half thought out prescriptions because
Yeah.
I'm a thinker, I'm not a doer,
Right.
right? So I'm like, I don't know how to, I don't live in black and white. I live between shades of gray. So then everyone says that I'm flip-floppy, which to be fair, like, yeah, I am, but it's because I don't want to have to choose something. I love this fence and I'm gonna sit on it.
I love this
I
fence
love
and I'm
this
gonna
fence
sit on it. I fucking
and
love
I'm gonna
that.
sit on it. And I like that about myself, honestly. I think that
Yeah.
more people should be that way. I really do. I think that more people should be more adaptable and, be more open to new information.
What does that mean though? Like, is there like a stance you have? Hold on, I'm just checking our volumes too, guys. Let me know how they go. I can see the chat a little bit, but not I'm not looking at it too hardcore, guys. So if you guys just let me know how the sound goes for me and laugh. I will say I had this conversation on my Discord the other day where they're like, you need to be more clear with what your values are. And I was like, what does that fucking mean? I get told I'm black and white. I get told I'm too wishy-washy. I get told I'm too. I'm like, guys, I have to know the context of the situation, but then I'm trying not to push my ideas onto people because I actually don't want to convert people to my direction. I just want to share it to see if it benefits them, but it probably won't.
Exactly,
You
yeah.
know what I mean? Like, how good is my advice to a religious, like, celibate person? Like, the fuck?
Totally.
You know? So the thing for me is, I understand that in our life, we go through moments where we throw everything at the wall and see what sticks, and then sometimes we change it up. So, are you okay with the idea that in the future you're gonna have those moments where you're really gonna have to face yourself and realize, like, oh shit, I'm gonna have to take that back? You seem fine with that, but are you like saying, okay, I'm gonna take it back? Like what I did wrong or what I said earlier?
Yeah, so I'm fine with that, but other people are not fine with that.
No,
And
they're
that's so
not.
no, so that's the problem is that I don't care about optics. This has been my thing since the beginnings. This is like the first criticism that Steven gave me is that I should care more about how people see me. And I'm just like, I don't have that. I think most people live their life in shoulds. I don't have it. I don't have it. I'm not like I should be this person. I'm just a feeler. And I will tell you how I feel, which doesn't look great. And it's not like pretty packaged. It doesn't make me the most like efficient debater, right?
Let's talk about optics because I heard you say something that was really interesting. You talked about a couple of things in yesterday's live show where you said things like individual liberation is not the same as like women's liberation. I thought that was on point. It's very important. There's a total difference, but people might not know that. And then the second thing is that the optics of sex work can create an environment in which the sex worker is dehumanized on a larger scale than not dehumanized. Right? So I got to the point in my introspection journey where I felt like, who was I outside of all the bubbles and outside of everyone telling me what I should be, outside of the optics, Who was I? And then I decided to live that life, but I'm super aware that I live in a society and that society's optics of me or how they see me can either land me in jail or canceled off the internet. Or so in those ways, I'm super cautious because, like, I don't want people to misunderstand me. I don't want people to go around telling people I'm a Nazi cult leader. You know, that really hurts my feelings. But I understand that people are also coming from bubbles of reality where they can't help but see me that way. Like, no matter what I say or what I do, I will always be that person.
Yeah.
How do you make peace with that reality that you're entering into a sphere outside of even sex work? YouTube itself, Twitch itself is dehumanizing. They will objectify you.
Yeah. I mean, I think I'm making peace with it. I'm trying to make peace with it now. I think this is why I have such a soft spot for Max, I think, is because I watched him mess up so many times and saw myself in it so much. Because I think Max is the same thing as me, where he's just like, he really is genuine, but sometimes it's a little maladaptive.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with me. Like, I don't claim to be, like, the perfect person. I'm very flawed. So I am just, like, at the liberty of everyone else's opinion of me, truly. Mm-hmm. But I do have, like, a strong, like, I know who I am. I think the thing is that I do all of this, like, for fun. So, like, I'm not really worried about, like, building an audience in the way that, like, most people are worried about, like, building an audience or, like, sustaining or getting money off of this, right? Like, it's not, this isn't my job yet, right? I'm just sort of, like, enjoying the time that I have here. So I think I have a less incentive to sell myself as, like, currently. Some sort of. Yes.
But eventually, do you want to make, because I'm confused about the sex worker stuff too. Like, I know you're making a lot of money in OF, but now you're on Patreon, which we love. Patreon's very sex friendly, like very sex positive, whatever. So that's great. But I know you're having a journey with seeing yourself. Like, I know, because, okay, I always say I don't want to make money either. I don't care if I make money on sex work because but I like doing it, but it's like a side gig. But I also post nude all the time for free. My first nudes were always free. I've walked around Seattle naked. I've done nudist parades.
Yeah.
But I also hang out with nudists. So it's different. It's like I get a space where I get to be naked and not sexualized.
Yeah.
Right? And so I'm used to that energy. So I try to bring that energy to my OF. But I also masturbate on my OF. So it's like I want people for both energies. Do you want to watch me do my laundry naked? Or do you want to watch me masturbate when I feel like it? Which is like rare. I don't every day masturbate. Like, it's just whenever I feel sexy and I want to do it. Because I don't feel cute 24/7, girl. Like, I can't be a sex worker 24/7. These girls out here, these men out here hustling. So,
yeah.
When you look at yourself and you know eventually you're going to make it into money, how do you make peace with just yourself? Fuck the world. I don't give a fuck about them. When you're talking to yourself and you're like, okay, Lav, we're going to be naked. What is it about being naked you like?
I feel like femininity to me is like a religion. It's like very spiritual to me.
Yeah.
I love the shape of my body. I think I have like an extremely feminine shape.
You do. It's
beautiful. Thank you. but I love, I, to me, and this sounds narcissistic, but I love the shape of my body. It looks like art to me, and not just my body, the feminine form in general. So I love to look at other women's bodies. I love to see my own body naked. Mm-hmm. I also really love, like feeling desired, obviously, right? Like that's a really big thing for me is I'm very dominant sexually, and I'm very I like the idea of men like going crazy over seeing like my body, and even that feels sort of divine to me in a way.
Like you want to be worshipped.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. This is okay. I love this conversation because I have seen this in so many pretty women. But I am a girl who isn't in that version of it because I'm not an exhibitionist. I'm just a voyeur. I like to watch people, but I don't actually care if anyone ever comments or messages me about how hot I am ever. But when people notice a skill I've done or something like that, I feel rewarded. So I'm very man-brained in that way. But I still like being naked because I like the feminine energy. I like the feminine body. I like looking at women naked. I think women are just – my whole room is nude art. Like every time I go to an art gallery,
nude art.
Oh, it's everywhere, girl. Yeah. My mouse pad is two girls in their boobs. Like I'm just like – I love women so much. I love – like I'm obviously I'm bisexual. So like I just – I love it so much. I can't stay away from it. I'm addicted. Like my family – I recently – I brought my partner home to meet my siblings and the priest. We have a priest who's a friend. And he goes, so now that you are monogamous, he goes, are you going to stop getting naked on the internet? And I was like, oh, what does that have to do with each other? And I was like, no. And then my partner was like, no, I don't care if she's naked. But look how they thought that me being in love would mean I wouldn't be on the internet naked, which is fair. That's true for a lot of people. But that's a part of my relationship negotiations. If you want me to get off OnlyFans or off being naked, we're not compatible. Because I don't think there's anything unethical about nudity.
Totally.
What do you think, though? Is there something about nudity that is wrong in any way, or?
I don't think so. And I mostly just, I take like a hyper individualistic approach where I don't think that like a relationship means that you own your partner at all. Mm-hmm. But also I am also in an open relationship. So mm-hmm. I'm like, this is your body. This is your personal journey. I'm choosing to be next to you and be partners throughout this life with each other. Because I love you and because I trust you to make decisions that honor me and mm-hmm. you.
Yeah, yeah.
But ultimately, if you need to go fuck off and do whatever you want to do, I am never going to take your agency away in this like very quick life that we have. I want you to have every experience that you could have under the sun. I want you to feel fully fulfilled by the time that you die.
Totally.
Or feel like you tried, right?
Right.
So that's where I'm at with that stuff. And like, my fiance has never cared ever about me being naked on the internet ever. I think he finds it pretty sexy, actually. I think that I think he likes that he has something that so many people like want.
Yeah, I think that's a part of it. I think we all feel a little bit of ego when we're like,
totally
scored, I got her, she's mine,
totally,
yeah,
totally. So yeah. I don't, it's not, and I'm also like, I don't have like parasocial relationships with these people. But again, still, even if I did have a relationship with these people, it's like, we're open, so it's like I potentially could not with someone paying to see my nudes, but
well, here's the thing, here's a rule I have. I feel like if you haven't paid for my nudes, you don't respect my work.
Yeah,
so if you're gonna date me and you tell me, oh, I bought your OnlyFans, I'm like, thank you for supporting my work.
Oh yeah, no, I wouldn't. If you, yeah, if you, I, if you met me and then sub to it, I'd be like, okay. But if we like met through there, that's,
I feel like that'd be weird, right? Okay, but I will say this. There's a difference between, okay, hold on. There's a whole theory, okay, about this. Like, there is, mm-hmm. I will say, I have gone on dates with people through OnlyFans. And I've gone on dates, because I think like sex workers are people and we date people and I want people who date me to love my work. But it's the energy they bring to it. So if I like, I always give like first date like tests, questions, not like tests, but I ask them like moral questions. And then if they're like, oh, I'm good with everything, I'm like, red flag. I just said a bunch of controversial things like that. I believe like you should probably have an issue with some of that, or explain why you don't. Like, what if we have trans kids is my favorite one to ask people, because it like stops them. And they're like, what does that mean? I was like, what if we have, how sex positive do you want to be around our kids? I'm on OnlyFans. Should I like perform in front of the kids? And then I want to see how they act, because it's a true question. I've seen sex workers basically perform either around or with their kids in the next room, which is like, for me, too shady, but for some people, their lifestyle. Yeah. So I'm trying to weed out people that, are we actually the same morally? Just because you like me naked, do you like why I'm naked? So I wanted to ask you, because I have a theory about you, that you actually simply just enjoy being nude and being expressive and putting together photo shoots, like your blood photo shoot in the bath, or what was the bath, right? It's like, that is just something you like to do, so you do it. Is that accurate or no?
Yeah. I mean, I did that when I didn't have an OnlyFans. I was still posting nude photos. I'll do it for free. But I figure, like, I might as well make money off of it.
Right, of course. Well, you'd be a fool not to.
Yeah, but I'm, like, completely an exhibitionist also. Like, I do like being naked for myself. I love to, like, look at myself naked. I love to see people naked. I'm also a voyeur in that way. But I also do, like, I really like the fact that people... Like, sexually, it makes me feel gratified to know that other people are getting horny when they look at me.
Oh, okay. That's an exhibitionist, right? To get turned on, yeah. By being watched, to be seen, yeah. Be desired. I think it's so, yeah. Reasonable if that's your thing. If that's your kink, that's your thing. Like, it makes sense to,
yeah.
Me.
The only thing is, I've talked about, I don't know how much of this is like, because I started sex work so early in my budding sexuality, I don't know how much of that is like conditioned, or if, yeah. That's just like, so that's a worry that I have, is like, okay, because also sometimes I don't feel good about it. Like, but it's obviously like, you know, if my stuff gets leaked, I'm like, okay, I don't like that people are seeing this, right?
Interesting.
Because like, that feels like a violation.
You know what? Okay, 5% of me does feel a little annoyed with it because of the principle of the fact that I'm like, this is paid content, sir. Why are you doing this? And also, I'm trying to keep my family from Googling me. Okay.
So that's the biggest thing. Yes.
I told my parents years ago, because my dad accidentally Googled. I told him, I was like, wait, okay, rule, do not Google me.
Yeah.
And so now that's a thing. But now my parents live in constant fear that their relatives are going to find it. And I have had some of my cousins, the little bitches, message my mom and be like, do you know what your daughter's doing in the internet?
Yeah.
And then my mom's like, girl, she's 30, like 3 years old. Leave her alone. And then my mom calls me and goes, get that shit off the internet. And I'm like, no. And then I don't. So like, that's the thing is like, I do want to do this because I know I'm called to like enjoy the human body. I invest in artists that do nude art. I like have my favorites. I don't think there's anything unethical about nudity, but the context of it can be difficult emotionally. I can get my feelings hurt when people don't know how to treat me like a person when I'm naked. Like, I don't understand their inability to do this.
Totally.
But I understand that's part of being a human, and some humans can't. But it's still weird to me. And then even the men I know who are super sex positive, some of them really struggle to not brag while talking about their people. Like, oh, I'm just relaxing like a naked girl. I'm like, what does that matter? When you just say if nudity wasn't a big deal, when you just say I'm chilling with my girlfriend, like, why are you bragging that you're with a naked girl unless the nudity is the part that's... Do you know what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
Society.
Because like when I hang out with my nudist friends, they don't sit there and be like, we're in a room full of naked people. They just say, we're hanging out with friends. Do you want to come over? Oh, by the way, we're naked today. It's a different vibe, girl. So like when you look at your life and you're picking what vibe you want, do you have a sense of direction? I know you mentioned me on stream the other day about how you liked how like I've been making content a particular way. And I am an outlier. I don't give a fuck about my customers' fantasies. I will take requests, but I don't take customs anymore. I like that people want to give me tips on what they'd like to see if it overlaps with whatever I like to
make. What you want. Yeah.
Exactly. If it's not something I want to do, I won't do it. One guy was so sweet. He offered me like, I don't know, money to like do a thing that he really liked, was like gaping asshole stuff. And I really appreciate that that's his thing, but I just wouldn't be proud of that if I did it.
Yeah, totally.
It wouldn't speak to my aesthetic, like as an artist. It wouldn't make sense to me as like a brand. But I'm not kink shaming him, or like, I don't want to shame him for his desires to see gaping assholes. I just want to be able to say, ooh, that's not my thing. I don't think I'd feel pretty doing that. I feel like I think I'd feel ugly about myself.
Yeah.
But that's just me. Because I like to make aesthetically pleasing things, like things that are, and I don't think gaping assholes are classy. But that's okay if you like it. It's okay if you like it.
Yeah, no, I'm completely understand that. And I tried to explain this to Steven on stream yesterday, and he like wouldn't get it. And I think it's ridiculous. But I was like, you know, the pictures that I'm posting are so different than what I'm critiquing that is like facial abuse porn. Like, it is so different. And you pretending like they're the same thing.
Yeah, sex workers might is the same.
Exactly. So I'm like, all my critique is still completely valid just because I'm on Patreon now. And especially like, and he was like, just because you're doing educational content. Yeah, doing educational content is very, very different than what I was doing fucking 19, doing my barely legal facial abuse, like do whatever the fuck you want to me thing.
Right.
I have no problem. And I've explained this to him like 60 times. Sex work is not the problem. Watching someone be naked and sexy is not the problem. It's the culture around it. It's the way that we treat women who are in the way that the pipeline in which, you know, a lot of women join sex work, you know, the women who fall through the cracks, like that is the problem. None of me going back to Patreon does not negate any criticism that I've had about the sex industry. Oh my God. Both of our cats.
I love them. Okay, I agree with you on this. I think this is the complicated part of everything. Look, I love drugs. Am I going to sit here and pretend that weed doesn't cause psychosis in some people?
Yeah.
Like, how hard is it just to say, yeah, the things we love can also fuck other people over in ways that are so awful, like really sad. So when I have young people come to me and they say, I really want to be a sex worker, I'm like, okay, I love that for you. Let's talk about what that looks like. And then I usually tell them the good and bad of it. So one time I had a guy. He had a problem. He ended up having this parasocial relationship with me. And I always struggle with this. No matter how many times I explain to like sane adults, and most of the time it works, 99% of the time it works. You just get a couple once in a while, like my boundaries, they don't always hear it. So this guy, you know, got to know me, kind of fell in love. And I told him, oh, it looks like we've crossed that line of healthy and I should probably like, we should separate. I have no intention of meeting you in real life. I was open to meeting viewers. I'm always open to meeting viewers, but not viewers who think it's now going to be best friends or lovers or something like that. It's too far. And so he was like, fine, can I buy a custom video from you? And I was like, oh, okay. This was years ago. I was making customs. I go, yeah, of course. And so he puts in the request for the custom. It's a facial blowjob scene with a fake, obviously a dildo. And he wants me crying and tearing up. And he wants me to be saying, I'm a dirty, worthless piece of shit. I'm an awful person. Like, really. And I'm like, okay, so now you're just trying to get revenge on me. Because I won't be your friend. And you're trying to pay me to do something that makes me look humiliated. So you can jerk off to knowing that at least you humiliated Brittany Simon. Super fucked up. Right? Yeah. Like, I was like, okay, this feels mean. And I feel really uncomfortable. I'm just going to block you. So I told him, I was like, this is not okay. This doesn't feel genuine. So I understand that this is going to happen. But as a good businesswoman, that's when you get rid of customers and you try to curate an audience that isn't going to demand those types of things of you, right? So that's the part of it where I feel like it is empowering for the individual. But women in general don't always benefit as a whole from sex work, period. We benefit from a whole for having bodily agency and autonomy over ourselves. Right?
Yeah.
So I think that that's the dilemma, just like you were saying. I don't know how nobody was able to engage with you yesterday. How hard was it to understand what you were saying?
This Steven has been on this like crazy fucking arc.
He's on
arc.
His period.
Dude, I have a bone to pick with Steven. He's like, he's been so unempathetic. And I think that his audience doesn't respond to me very well because I don't think that they're very empathetic. They're like a bunch of debate bros who are like, you know, I'm logic only. And a lot of his audience now is, you know, come from other communities like the Groiper Nick Fuentes community. So like, whatever, they're their own beast. But I think that he's like allowed them and all these men that he engages with who are like online all day and like don't really engage with women to like solely his, because in person, because me and Steven met up in person as friends.
Great.
And he was so normal. He was so normal, so friendly, so sweet. And then yesterday online, he's like, he told me to shut up, you stupid bitch. I was like,
I heard it. He was mad.
I was like, okay, I get that you're emotional right now. You do not get to talk to me like that. And also, who the fuck is this person? Like, I have not met this person. Like, you were not like this in person. You're doing this for a show. And you're also denigrating me in front of 8,000 people who you know love to fucking see this. You're humiliating me.
I will tell you this. Because Steven's such a considerate friend to me, at least so far. He's been really gentlemanly and lovely. I think that when I was viewing him, I was like, somebody's on his period. Like, you're in your emotional feelings. I don't know what's going on in private. I don't know what's going on in your life. But that feels a little bit in the way he reacted to Amaranth. So I'm just going to say, generally speaking, I think tensions are very high on the internet right now. And it feels like everyone feels hurt. Even listening to Cherry and Mr. Girl talk about, like, him exposing himself maybe or whatever. I was like, okay, there's a lot going on here that just needs to stop. Everyone needs to calm down and just separate it out. So what I want to do is, like, I don't want to be involved in that drama, girl. That's why I unfollowed everyone off Twitter. I was like, no. I need lightness. I need, like, none of this heaviness because it's too much. I like everyone individually. And I know that sometimes we won't get along. But I feel like this is because we're not listening or hearing each other. Like, Steven feels it's your obligation to move people in his direction, right? He told me in a conversation that he would like to convince people to be like him. I would like to convince people to think about ways to find joy in their life, even if it doesn't match how society is telling you to live.
Totally. I'm the same way.
Okay. So when you operate like that, that means I can also understand how things can go complicated. So sex work isn't perfect, but neither is any job. So when I heard you say, I can do sex work and still have issues with it, I was just like, yeah, doesn't everyone have a job that they have issues with and they have to work out? Isn't that normal? Do we all love YouTube? Doesn't ABBA and Destiny literally make a career talking about TOS and how YouTube sucks? And then they're getting on here and acting like sex work is going to be... That's a problem, though. Some women have sold sex work as, like, the greatest thing in the world when it's, like, very complicated.
Yes. Okay, so this is also my thing because they were like, you were so mad at Madame Genevieve. Are you embarrassed now? And I'm like, no. I got up there. She didn't acknowledge that women's liberation and personal empowerment were, like, not the same thing.
She didn't
acknowledge that she's had any negative experience with sex work. She said that
maybe
she would.
Maybe she hasn't, though, right? Has she?
No, sure. But she couldn't acknowledge. She was like, if someone wanted to, I would tell them that they should. I've helped a lot of people get into it. And instantly, this is like alarm bells for me because I'm like, okay. And she wouldn't let me say how negative it was for me.
I get it.
Okay, but it's not like that for everyone. And I'm like, I need you to just fucking listen to me. Mm-hmm. Like, I need you to let me say my negative experience with sex work. and without you putting a fucking band-aid on it, without you saying that this is like empowerment. That is what I got fucking angry at. But it seemed like she was too fucking stupid.
It's, I don't know her, and I don't know her work very well. I think she's the blonde one, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So I would like to talk to her too, maybe eventually. I don't know if she knows who I am, but one of the things I've noticed is that when we're in a political movement, and I don't know if she is, but we try to brand our political movement as like always good so we can get the legislation to make it legal and then we can talk about the bad. The dilemma is that I left that because I actually felt like I was getting gaslit when I was trying to have conversations about the bad of what was going on. And everyone's like, shh, don't talk about it. It looks bad as a brand. And I was like, okay, so I'm out then. I'm just going to talk and I'm going to make my thing a philosophy thing and I'm going to be able to say, I love this thing and it can hurt me. I love this thing and it can hurt me. Like, is this not like the epitome of being a person on earth?
Totally, totally.
And I don't understand why we're so, but again, if you're in politics, then you are and feel obligated to move people in a direction for where I just don't feel that way. So if people come to me and say, I really want to do sex work, I always ask why.
Yeah.
Because you better be ready for your dad to see your coochie. You ready for your mom to like accidentally open up her phone? Girl, I got to get a separate phone. You know how many times I've accidentally sent my parents? I sent my sister a thing for OnlyFans once.
I sent my manager a photo with cum all over me once.
No!
It was horrifying. I called him immediately. I was like, Spencer, you cannot look at your phone. You cannot look at your phone. Get your girlfriend to go on your phone right now and delete this photo. And then she has to see it to delete it. It was horrifying. Ugh. My fiance's ex-girlfriend found out, showed his mom my shit.
Why do they do that?
Dude, why the fuck insecurity.
They do that? So stupid.
Dude, it's so gnarly. And then some guy that my mom was dating showed her like this video that leaked of me that he'd like found somehow. This my mom's boyfriend. I'm like, so you got to be prepared for like bad bullshit to be happening to you.
And you have to be prepared for even some of your I'm about to talk mad shit. So listen, here's the thing. I'm not gonna name no names. But if I had a dollar for how many people amongst the women's sort of drama and bullshit and just like gossiping about these women who are all in the same industry to get ahead, I'm like, guys, make a decision. Now it feels that way. I'm sure Genevieve. I'm sure if she feels emotionally connected to sex work, she's going to feel like any attack on it is like an attack on her, which is fair.
Mm-hmm.
And it can feel that way. Totally. I feel that way sometimes too. So I think the way to go about these conversations is to say, first of all, what bubble do you live in? Let's use my language, but there you go. It's to say, what do you see as reality? What is going to, like, what is really going to work for you? So I purposely posed naked on Tumblr for free the first time to make sure this was something I wanted to do because I wanted to do it. And that informed the rest of my life. Now, I did it in my 20s, in my early 20s. I didn't have sex till I was 22. And then about 24, I think I posed naked for the first time, maybe. I think it was about that time. And I remember my boyfriend at the time, like, we had very separate lives. And so he was like, yeah, do you? And I did it. And it was great. It felt, those pictures to this day are my favorite set I've ever done. Because I was like, that was really me owning my body. I was so, but do you know? And I think I told you this, maybe I didn't. When I opened up my OnlyFans for the first time in 2019 or whatever it was, 2020, that was the first time I ever showed my full pussy on screen. I just never did it before because I was like, no, it's mine. And then finally I was like, I'm ready. So do you see how, like, when you look at my life, I made the decisions of when I was ready?
Totally.
And that's the thing is that when you go through life making those decisions, it's much easier to own them. But if you feel forced or maybe pressured and then you have to ask yourself, do I even like this? That's an experience that I'm learning from you because I've never had
totally. Totally. Yeah. You know I think I needed the break to be, you know, obviously I think that the way that I engaged in sex work before when I was 18 and, you know, going into it was like not, it was harmful to me and the harm outweighed the benefit to me at that point. But then having the 2 months away from it, posting for free, realizing I was like, oh, I do like this. Like, I do like this. I was able to really solidify that I was making a choice instead of like falling into something. I was like, Sauron, I need you to not. Jesus, he wants to be the center of attention. Typical man.
I love it.
But yeah, it was like, it really solidified for me that I was making that choice for myself. And that choice is like really important when it comes to sex work because it is the most boundary driven job. You have to have such hard boundaries. Yeah. Because you're being so vulnerable and so intimate. And yeah, so
and people are, I'm sorry. It's like the bubbles. So I always just calm myself down to say, like, this is a person who comes from this belief system and this is how they feel they can talk to people. So like I don't have them right now. Right now, all my followers are really dope and like really good about boundaries. But in the past, I've had people who will tip and be like, I want to be your slave. And I'm like, I don't do that. I want to be your pay pig or something. I was like, I don't do that. I get it. I'm into it for other people. I can't do it. I don't know how to have boundaries with it. I can't understand the mechanism. And so I think admitting that as a sex worker is number one, because it moves those people out of your sphere. In the beginning, I didn't know how to do it. So I did camming. I tried camming. I tried phone sex work. I tried doing different websites. I tried deciding, do I want to do porn? I really went through it and asked myself, what's going to bring me the most joy? Do I want to do cosplay stuff for the rest of my life? And I think when you're having that conversation with yourself, and I was always working two jobs before this, right? Before online work was my full-time work. I just worked a couple jobs, professionally nannied most of my 20s. And I could ask myself, what do I really want? So I could test it. Camming, you know what I didn't like about camming was trying to be cute in real time. Like trying to be in the moment in real time. And then the demand on me, I hate, girl, I'm such a rebel. When people demand I do something, they're like, I paid you. I want to kill myself or I want to kill
them. Exactly. Totally.
I hate that energy. I think it is so obnoxious. So I'm very gay with my work. You wouldn't go to a drag queen and be like, do what I say, bitch. She'd be like, the stiletto about to be up your ass.
Yeah.
So that's totally, the attitude totally. I take on with sex work. My job is to, as an artist, because I consider myself a sex worker artist, is not to give the customer a fantasy, but to fulfill my own. And then hopefully the people who would like that fantasy will also benefit.
Totally. And that is the most liberating way to do sex work also.
Yeah, I love it.
Because we build our sexual scripts around the porn that we consume. Right?
Yeah.
So if you're watching porn, which, you know, like your type of porn or potentially hopefully my type of porn, you're not a man is not going to, it's not going to have the same effect on society as the current porn we are having is, right? Which again means that like sex work is not the inherently bad thing. It's just like overwhelmingly where we're at.
Yeah.
Like, which, and I think that criticism is fair. Like, I don't know.
And porn does impact men's brains different than women. So, like, I've been watching aggressive, rough porn for most of my life, mostly hentai, because I don't like watching real people be in pain, / I don't like watching real people fake orgasms. So totally. Those are the two things I don't actually like. And then in the BDSM way that I, in my own life outside of sex work, experience pain is more meditative and spiritual. So even I'm an anomaly in that regard. Because I don't usually involve orgasms in my BDSM and people think it's like, but it's actually pretty common. It's just not mainstream common. So I feel like what happens is that people are going into these industries, figuring themselves out, and then they can't take it back, which is difficult. And so I think that I've learned to just be resilient in that reality that I can't take it back. I'm ashamed of so many things I've done.
Totally.
I'm embarrassed of so many things that are on the internet. And I just have to be like, you know what? Past Brittany did what she did for her reasons. And it is what it is.
Totally. Right?
So it's not that I'm even, because I love CNC. I love role playing it. I love the hentai of it. I love all that. But I know that porn does change your brain and it can impact how boys are growing up and how young girls are seeing themselves. So when I talk to my partner about how sex positive we want to be, and I'm so curious about this for you, if you plan to have kids, like how naked do we want to be? How nude friendly do we want to be? Do we want to show them like kind of aggressive art? Do we want to wait until they're like older? And I think ultimately I want my kids to, if they find the porn on their own, it is what it is. But I'd like to encourage them to wait until their brain is a little bit more developed before they start thinking that this is what making love looks like, because it's not. This is a fantasy curated by an industry for a customer.
Totally.
But I don't think people want to be open about that. Now, I'm curious, though, what do you think about people on OnlyFans who do sort of like that rough sex work with their partners that they're married to or live with, and their customers know that's their partner? Do you think that changes anything?
No, I don't. I think that because it's still the way that the person who is the client is engaging in it is still, it doesn't matter to them because you don't matter to them, especially ultimately, I mean, it depends. I think most porn viewers, and this is again, like weeding out your audience, right? I think that you probably have a better audience, a more like a sensitive, empathetic audience than
they seem to be. They're really lovely to me. They treat me really well.
Yeah, which is what I'm trying to cultivate now. But I think that someone who would be into that sort of thing also is like already sort of, I don't know.
But
I don't want to
kink
shame. I don't want to kink shame.
I'm into that.
I know.
So why do you think I manage to be into it and not and still know how to treat people?
Well, but you don't. You said that you don't watch stuff like that.
Oh, I don't watch real people anymore. You're right.
Exactly. So even though you're into it,
that's like aliens up their ass and everything.
Sure, but that's not people. If you're getting off, like, absolutely. I think if you're watching, I don't understand how we're pretending like, and I don't think it makes you a bad person to be turned on by those things.
Totally.
I don't think it makes you a bad person. I think it's a maladaptive behavior that you should certainly work through, though. Like, I think that if you are watching a woman cry getting facially abused, you really need to think about your relationship with your mother. I think that it's, I think if you combat that and also are still sexually attracted to it, good for you, right? But
ooh,
I think nobody interacts with porn that way and internalizes it, right?
Okay, wait.
We should encourage people to do that.
I agree. Wait,
but we don't.
I really agree with this because I'll tell you this. I told Kyla this, Erudite, on a stream we did together where I talked about how I used to be a little. And in my 20s, I really needed that. Do you know what a little is in BDSM?
Yeah.
Okay. So I really needed that at the time. And then one day I woke up and I was like, oh, all right. And I packed all my little clothes and I gave them to Goodwill. And I was like, okay. And now I don't desire that. So I don't desire like a daddy. I'm not into little play anymore. I'm not into any of that. And she's like, so you outgrew it. Don't you think it's weird when people don't outgrow it? I was like, yes and no. I do think it's strange when I meet 42-year-old women who obviously were molested as children and are not over
yes.
their trauma.
Yes.
And I do meet them and they're lovely and I respect them. But I am open to the idea that our kinks can tell a story. So what I do is I take out all my kinks that I have and I trace them back to why I even like them. I found that a majority of my kinks, not all of them, were from positive experiences.
Interesting.
So I started to think about that. And now it makes sense, though, because my life was actually relatively okay. I had a lot of hard emotional issues. I have borderline, all that stuff. But I know that I also have loving parents and a good solid home. And even though my family and I argue about like religion and stuff, we always have each other's back. So a lot of the times when I was exploring feeling loved, I only did it through pain. So like in my former relationships, I didn't know how to make love. Like, I didn't know how to make eye contact with my partner. And I was like, can you just, like, pull my hair and shove me into a bed and fuck me from behind and make me cry?
Yeah, same,
and,
yeah.
And now that I've gone through some healing moments, I can make love now. Like, I can look my partner in the eye and I can, like, be a girl. And it's so lovely. And be, like, softly touched by him. Like, he can
–
this is – so with my ex-partner, if he would softly touch me or, like, show me love, I'd be like, nah, what are you doing? And then, like, it was, like, uncomfortable. But this partner now, he can just – treat me like a girl and I accept it. And it's really lovely. But I know that I had to grow through that. So I'm not saying that is the end, happy ending for everybody.
Yeah.
But for me, when I really examined myself, yeah, I got over certain things because I didn't need that idea of that power dynamic anymore.
Totally. And I have the same experience with like sort of the BDSM stuff. But for me, it was like, yeah, I was really into... For me, I felt I was like neglected throughout most of my childhood. So, you know, whichever way a man would take me, I would like be happy, right? And I think that there's something really special about BDSM because you're so focused in a way that like you are not maybe present during like other forms of sex because
totally.
You kind of have to because sometimes it's dangerous or sometimes it's whatever. And it's also like it's also a maladaptive kink. So you would be kind of like entranced by it. That was like the first time I'd had sex with a man and he like really looked at me and paid attention to me the whole time. And
yeah.
I was like, I love this.
Oh.
And then once I combated that, I was like this, I want love.
Yeah.
And this is not love.
Yeah.
And then the first time I asked my fiance to like hit me, I was like, slap me hard across the face. He was like, no. And I was like, what do you mean? I was like, you don't love me. My
yeah.
first reaction was like, you don't love me.
Yeah.
And he was like, no, I don't want to hurt you. And that was like, I was like, oh, fuck. I think I've been doing something wrong. And then once I combated that, I was like, oh, like how many women are doing this? I'd bet a lot.
Enough that I think it's smart to talk about it. How many boys are doing this? How many people are doing
yes.
this? How many men are... People are
totally.
Just doing it. We're all doing it. We're experimenting, which is
yeah.
why I think at certain times in your life, this could be what you need. And so if you
yeah.
need it, you got to do it consensually, hopefully, safe words, all that stuff. I've
exactly.
been slapped in the face a lot in my life. And
yeah.
I did love it then. I did. It's funny with my partner now, I don't – I don't think that's something we'll end up doing. And I don't know what that means because I'm like, okay, I just don't need it anymore. Like, I don't – that part of Brittany that existed that needed to be, like, heavily masochistic in that way, which is different. Guys, I mean, I'll just be blunt with you. I've been urinated on. I've been spit on. I've been, like – you know, I've been punched. I've been slapped. I've been cut. I've been all of it. And all of it was for me. I needed it to explore my limits, to say, Brittany, look how tough you are, to also understand what my body was capable of, my psychology was capable of, to know where I could go. And at this stage of my life, I'm not saying that it's this way for everyone, but I just don't need to be hurt that way anymore. I need slow.
Really beautiful.
I need cuddles and kisses and makeout sessions to MasterChef. Like, I need. I need to be treated really softly. Makes sense.
Yeah. That makes sense. I would, it's funny because I'm not there. Well, I was there and I am there, but I'm not, I've actually overcorrected. And I'm exploring sadism.
Ooh, so you're the sadist.
Yeah.
Oh wait. Okay. I love being a sadist. That's great. Okay. I love this. Yeah. Show. Okay. Great. Yeah.
So, which actually has been very healing for me, because I feel like in some sense, like I am taking power back.
Yeah.
And I also feel like very in control. I'm like a dom sadist for the first time in my life. And I'm like, fuck, this feels like really good right now. And I, at first I was like, oh, because I've always been bratty.
Yeah.
I was like, oh, maybe I was just like hiding it. Maybe I was like a dom that was like hiding it. But now that I look about it, especially after hearing that, I'm like, no, I think that this is just who I am right now. Like it wasn't under thing. It's just like, this is what I need right now. And then maybe I'll measure out and go back to having like loving sex. And I still do have like mostly like loving soft sex, but still sometimes I'm like, fuck, I really do like to cause a little pain.
Oh,
and
me too.
but I'm also like, you know, this, and people get mad at me for being the whole like, you know, do as I say, not as I do. But I also think that like I am someone who is like really introspective. So I'm not doing anything that I don't know is going to like affect me in a certain way. And I'm hyper aware of how it's affecting me.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that I'm telling that I'm the exception.
Right.
It's that there are exceptions.
Right.
But you need to be very aware of yourself. And I just don't think that people are aware enough.
No, so I agree.
So the prescription is like, okay, just avoid it unless you are this person.
Right.
And I feel like that's fine to say, but people get really mad at that.
I like to say, do it whoever you are, and I don't give a fuck. Have fun destroying your life, bitch, because we're all got to go through it. Like, that's my thing.
Yeah.
Like, because I do, look, I give advice. If people take it, they don't take it. It's not up to me. But I, as I grew into my 30s, I'm much more toppy, much more dominant, and I am much more sadistic. Because I can actually take care of someone now. So, like, I am the caretaker. Like, I am this person who can do this, and I love it, but I'm a switch. So, like, my partner and I are both switches. We just switch every second, which is really lovely. Mm-hmm. But I think what is the big deal for now versus then is that now I'm just not the Brittany that I was then. I didn't end up the person who continued her kinks to her 50s in the same way. I have new ones, different ones now. I have, like, different desires now to treat my partner. This is the first partner that I have wanted to genuinely honor their feelings and their emotions and their thoughts to such a degree that it's like making me feel like a way I've never felt before. I'm just like, this is such a beautiful human, and I want to do everything I can to make them happy, and hopefully vice versa, obviously. But it came with a different energy with me. I can't go back to being this like bottom brat that I used to be that needed like a daddy dom. I appreciate that, Brittany. It was so good for my 20s. Like, I needed it so badly. I don't have it as much now. But the person that I am now is just different. She's just, like, a different person. And that's the thing that's going to happen with all of us is I don't think there's a goal. I don't think you should aim to say that, oh, your masochism should happen before. Maybe it happens in your 50s. Maybe you're a bratty bottom little in your 50s. I don't know. Because not everyone is introspective enough to have the conversation with themselves to explore their kinks in their 20s. You're kind of lucky. I remember meeting people at the Dungeon Girl in their 90s, and they were like, I missed out my whole life. And I'm like, it's okay. You can start at 90. No biggie.
Yeah.
Everyone starts to explore themselves at different stages of their life. You know?
Yeah, that'd be crazy.
Do you plan to be naked at 90? Because I do. I'm going to be on OnlyFans at 90. Girl, I'm going to show my sagging tits for sure.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that, I don't know, but I also, I am still, I don't know. My grandparents are very like, are you going to do this when you have kids? And so I'm like, I have a lot of shame attached to like becoming like my mother, and my mother was very hypersexual. Hmm. So I'm like, I want to avoid that by like overcorrecting.
Okay.
I have the propensity to overcorrect for sure. Things that my mom did. So I'm like, I don't know. I think I would just, by the time I have kids, I don't think I'll be doing it anymore. Not because, I don't know. It's hard to say because I don't know how much of it is like shame or how much of it is like actually me and how I feel.
So fair. So fair. It's such a journey. No, I just, you know, having this conversation with my partner, I do want to be a sex worker mother. I do want to do exactly what I'm doing now, but with kids 3 years from now, girl, I should pop out my first. Let's go. It's mm-hmm. like everything's on track, whatever. But I don't want my kids to think I'm ashamed of what I do because I don't think I experience shame in relation to my sex work. But again, I had sex at 22 when I wanted. Even my assault came after I had sex for the first time. So I felt like everything I did in my life was mostly my choice in relation to my nudity.
Interesting, because I don't feel shame in regards to my sex work either, but I feel like I
should.
Like, I feel, yes.
Totally. That's the bubble. Like, so the bubble is informing you. You should feel shame, but your personal values don't actually reflect that.
Yeah. Yeah, but I'm not usually, like, a should person. So it's, like, a very, like, it's, like, a quiet voice that I'm, like, aware of, but I'm totally. Not, like, actually. So it feels like my voice because I'm, like, oh, I don't care about shoulds, but it's, like, it's so hyper-present that I'm like, is this what I think? I don't know. But yeah, I don't think that there's anything wrong with it. But also, like, you hear it enough times that it's like, you know.
Everywhere. You hear it all the time. And then people, no. That's so normal. If anyone's listening to this, that is so fucking normal to ask yourself, is this what I believe? Or is this what my bubble has told me to believe? And what should I do about that? And without shaming the bubble, because they can live how they want, how do I separate myself or find a different bubble? Like, I mean, I counsel a lot of people or do calls with a lot of people, whatever you want to call it. Who are like couples in open relationships because they know I did it for so long. And I'm like, guys, okay, so like in your bubble, this is open, like Fresh and Fit style. In this bubble, this is hippie Seattle open. In this bubble, this is how you do it. Everyone does it different. So you can't assume like that this is the end all be all to your reality. If you don't like the way your life is going, you might just need to move. But that doesn't change the fact that people have opinions. My siblings, oh my gosh, like they are not all of them are very excited that I'm on OnlyFans, obviously. But I understand that they're very religious, right? Like, of course they're not excited. And of course they're hoping that I stop doing it. Why wouldn't they? Right?
Of course.
But to maintain respect amongst us, we just all acknowledge that, hey, we're all going to do things we don't agree with. Period. The end. We're going to do things with our kids we don't agree with. Like, my brother's going to teach his kids that, like, gay people and trans people are sinning. And I'm going to teach my kids that it's just, like, how people are. That's just how life goes sometimes. You're gay, you're trans, it's just life. And, like, that's the difference, right? I can still respect my brother and how he raises his kids because they're all loved and everything's great. They're very open with Auntie Brittany being a heathen. He tells his kids, he's like, Auntie Brittany is a gay heathen. And I'm like, I'm gonna be with a man, okay? So, like, everyone, I'm trying to be straight here. It's not working. But it's, you know. And so, like, I love it. I love the openness. I love that my brother isn't gonna hide from his kids that I do sex work.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't want to lie to them. He wants to say, this is how the world is. And sometimes even the people we love do sex work.
Yeah.
Even the people we love sometimes do things that aren't proper to us. But they're still
good people. That's really
beautiful. Oh, yeah. We're really lucky. We've had to do a lot of ups and downs, a lot of therapy on my end to communicate these differences. Yes, yes. But that's the thing. So when you're on the internet and you guys are all having these debates, sometimes I feel like, okay, is this really what we want? Is this the energy we want for each other? Like, do you feel fulfilled by those conversations?
Yeah.
Okay. In what way? Is it the adrenaline pumping? Is it the debate? Is it the back and forth?
I'm not sure.
Is it the views? Is it the good business move? Like, that's all great. You're running a business. Make that money.
Yeah, I don't know. I think I just like to be... I think I was so lonely for so long because I didn't know what was wrong with me before I like figured out that I was like autistic because my mom hid it from me. Mm-hmm. I was like, I felt so like on the outskirts of everything. I like, I was always reading. I like always had my nose in a book. I didn't have many friends. So I think that right now I just like, I love to have conversations because I feel less lonely.
Yeah, totally.
Which is like seems like a very like simple but it is really simple, and that's why I don't matter like how I look if I win.
Yeah,
I'm just happy to be having a conversation with someone, which sounds a little pathetic, But
I built a whole career off of being a conversationalist because I want to talk to people all day.
Sure. So it's like I really like having these conversations. I like having hard conversations. And
you do really well. To be honest, you were obviously made to be a streamer because it takes a very specific person to sit on a panel and just have people fucking come at you. Right? Which is like, wait, when you guys did that to me and I got called in, and still, like, it's exciting because it's like, oh yeah, like, we do this. We're YouTubers, I guess. We're streamers. We're Twitch people. But there is a thrill I get from just having good energy mixed up. I like Destiny. I like everybody. I think Abba's great. I think you're great. I think Erudite's great. But I think I like different things from all of you. Yeah. And so I hope that eventually over time, like, my friendship with Destiny gets better, like, my relationship with Kyla gets better and stuff, and I hope we end up forming something really healthy and good together. But I have to always pick me first, no matter what. Totally. So that's like why I unfollow people on Twitter, just to give myself a mental break to say, oop, I can feel it coming. Like, we're, you know, consuming too much drama, stuff like that. Have you put those tools in for yourself since you're new to streaming and everything?
Recently, I tried. Recently, I was like, because the Cherry drama. So with the whole Cherry thing, Cherry, started going over all my content, like, from my very beginning. And then I tuned in because I saw, I was part of her Discord, and she was like going over Lavloon content, and I was like, oh, this is weird, click, because we also had scheduled like a conversation.
Oh, okay.
Because she wanted to talk to me, so I was like, oh, or I wonder what she's doing before talking to me or whatever. And then I watched, and she was like, this is a manipulation tactic that Lav is doing. This is the most manipulative woman I've ever seen. She's just looking for Steven's attention. And I was like, whoa. Like, it was crazy. Hmm. And then I had in chat, I had been like, hey, you can like talk to me so you can get like a better understanding of me.
Yeah.
And then she would like, then she blocked me.
Oh.
And was like, get the fuck out of here. And I was like, oh, I was like, this is weird. Mm-hmm. And then I did leave. I watched for like maybe 15 more minutes, and then I was like, okay, I think I've had enough. Like, this is not good for me. Then the next night she had done it, and I was unbanned from chat at this point. So I was like, you know, I had watched for like an hour, and she said, I hate her now. The only conversation we're going to have is out of loathing. And I was like, oh geez. And then I commented LOL ? Or something along those lines. And then I guess earlier that day I had talked about the night before watching it, mm-hmm. and been like, watching it was like self-harming. Like, I couldn't look away. It was like a car crash.
Yeah.
But I had said it in like a way that was like, ha ha ha. Like, Cherry was the worst person to walk in on doing that. Right. Like, it was very light. And she goes, get the fuck out of here. I'm not gonna partake in your self-harm. Get out of here. Mm-hmm. Here's the suicide hotline if you need it.
Yeah, I heard her bring it up in chat with you yesterday, but I don't really understand it. So I can't decide if everyone's just like in a really emotional place right now. So everyone feels a little bit hurt by everything, like Destiny having his moments, or even her. And I don't know who she is, so I don't know what context her work. I don't even know what she does. Is she a streamer?
Yeah.
Okay.
She's a drama streamer. Yeah. She like goes over people's content.
Okay, I have to look at her face because part of me wonders if she's the person I'm thinking she might be, but I don't know. But there are people, like, I can't watch Anna Vore talk about me. It triggers me. Not literally, but, like, she's so crazy that when she talks about me, it's just, like, I can't handle people telling me who I am when they're so far off. So I just can't listen.
Yeah, so I started to, with Cherry, that's why I said, like, this is so, because obviously Cherry has BPD. She's open about having BPD. Mm-hmm. She is obviously, like, very much in maladaptive paranoia behavior when she's, like, thinking that everyone is manipulating her. That's got to be a hard place to be, right? Yeah. Like, I feel empathy in that she's constantly looking for manipulation from everyone. That is a hard place to be, hard place to live. But when she's doing that to me and purposely misunderstanding me, and then she has 200 people watching her do that and like trying to change their minds about me, I'm like, okay, this is like extremely personal. Mm-hmm. I understand why you're doing it, and that you're not maybe even meaning to do this maliciously, because you could be seeing me as this manipulative person. But also, you cannot be so unaware of yourself that you think that like the people that you are telling this to are going to, like, now this informs their idea of me and they're going to abuse me with it.
That's funny. And that's, you're giving them fuel. That's exactly how I feel about Mr. Girl.
Yeah, I feel that way about Max too sometimes.
Yeah, like, that's what's so funny. So, okay, we're adults. We're all doing these things that are hurting each other. How do we stop? Yeah. How do we stop? Is there a solution other than just like making things and assuming like what
conversation and understanding, but like really understanding, which is why I was like, which is why I was like, Cherry, talk to me.
Right.
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 But then, but also you can't with people who are like, you're manipulating me, right? With like highly paranoid people.
Yeah.
You can't change their mind. So at some point I'm just like, okay, what the fuck ever. And then, I forget what happened that like really kickstarted it, but she like had come on stream. She had accused me of being manipulative and attention seeking to Steven, then goes on stream and was like, I'm doing video analysis on Lav. Do you think I should be doing this or is it weird? Like an adult woman asking him about content that she's making to like plug it. I'm like, okay, but you're accusing me of doing this.
Yeah. Can I just like say something that's like pretty obvious that people want Steven's attention? Like,
sure.
Everybody wants his attention. I want his attention because I think he's a good person to bounce ideas off of. But, like,
of
I don't think there's anything wrong with wanting his attention. But I think some people are not honest with the intention they want. There was a girl who was on stream with Steven one time, and at the end of it goes, I hope you get to have sex with Brittany. And I was like, why would you say that? I don't want to have sex with Steven. I'm monogamous. Why did you say that? Well, I wasn't monogamous at the time. I wasn't even dating anyone. But like, she doesn't know me. So what if I was like in a relationship and monogamous? Like, why would she say that? And then I kept wondering, like, why would she say that? And then I realized, like, I think she was just trying to be funny and then flirty with Steven. And then it was like a flirt through me. And like, maybe she's socially awkward, right? So I have to assume.
I mean, she's like, oh, you guys just like fuck already. But also the added drama behind this is that they had something public and she wrote a twit longer about him ignoring her.
Wait, who had something public?
So Cherry and Steven had like a thing.
Okay.
And Cherry wrote a twit longer about him like ignoring her. And how it made, and how they had like a sexual relationship and it really bothered her that he ignored her now. And now, weeks later, she's accusing me of this behavior, complete projection.
Mm.
And I'm like, Cherry, no. You don't get to spin this narrative about me, especially when this is out there about you. Come on. And everyone's like, this is spite driven. And I'm like, no, she doesn't get to take my narrative like this.
Oh my
like,
God. Okay. Number one reason not to have sex with Steven. I'm not dealing with any of that.
No, literally. No, literally. And I've talked to him about this before. I'm like, why are you having sex with these unhinged women? I'm like,
he's got a type. The man's got a type.
Dude, it's insane. And now everyone thinks that we're fucking because I'm on stream with him, which like whatever. Laugh.
Are you fucking?
No.
You promise?
I promise.
Okay.
I promise.
I believe you.
I promise.
Even if you did, it's all a part of the rules, right? Because you're both in open relationships. It's allowed to happen.
Yes. Yes. But we could someday. Who knows? Right now?
Ooh,
no.
Streamer orgy, everybody, with Max. Yeah, Kyla, literally. You, me. I'm just in the corner watching because I can't touch anyone.
Who's to say right now, after he talked to me the way that he did, it's looking like a no forever.
Okay,
but
got it.
Who's to say? If we have a connection, who cares, right? I'm open to it. But I'm not like, by no means, I'm very happy. I'm not trying to get this like fucking 34-year-old league player to fuck me. I don't have to try that hard, first of all, also.
Bro.
Cherry's acting like I'm begging for it. I'm like, if I wanted to fuck Steven, rest assured I would have already fucking done it.
The best thing about Steven is that he's a slut. That's like the greatest thing about him. He's so open. I'm like, I don't think he'd have a problem with it. I don't think it'd be that hard. If he's into it's not that hard to sleep with people as long as they're into
literally,
you. Right?
It made no so fucking funny. Sense. And she was painting me all these weird ways. And so then it became super personal. And then I was like, and then it became very vitriolic because I yelled at her on stream. And then I felt bad about it because I was like, okay, I'm feeding into this.
I saw your tweet and I appreciated that you said it was a low blow or something like that. You said something about her borderline, didn't you?
Yeah.
That was really respectable that you tweeted that out. I appreciate that.
Thanks.
Not that it matters, but I appreciate it.
But it was, I obviously was feeling I get stuck in ego a lot.
Totally.
I get stuck in ego a lot. Yeah. So a lot of that was like a very egoic. And then also like, it's fun to go on Steven's stream and like drama farm a little bit in the first call that me and Cherry had. Right.
Yeah.
Because at that point it just felt like petty beef. Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, then I'm like, okay, I'm over this. When I was like, okay, this is ego. I'm over it.
Mm-hmm.
Then I wake up the next morning. She falsely accuses Max of sexually harassing her.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay. I'm like, no, now everything I said about her being manipulative, vitriolic, like all these things is true.
No,
all
I
these
saw things those are videos. True. I saw those videos, and I would definitely say that it did look like his pants were down, but when he explained it, it was no big deal. And I do understand that from her perspective, it was interesting that she didn't check with her friends to double check before she went public. I wish I knew what she looked like so I could know if it's the girl.
She's like pretty. Of. She's like pretty black girl. She has.
Does she do
she's always
psychology in- stuff. Does she? Is she associated with Anna?
I think so, but I think they feud.
There was a girl who made a bullshit video about me on Twitch who might look like her, but I don't want to assume it's her. But it was the same time Anna was making videos, and like both of them were so fucking off calling me a narcissist and stuff. I was like, that's so mean. I'm just borderline, bro.
Did she have like a candle? She has a bunch of candles in a background.
I don't remember what her set looked like. Mm-hmm. I just remember she had hair that was kind of like long but straight but wavy, I think. And it like went down here and she sat on a couch. But I don't know what that means. It was months ago. I don't know. But I was like, I'm trying to figure out like who are just the bitches who are jealous and angry, and who are the bitches that are troubled and angry, and who are the bitches who are like working on their shit. And I'm just trying to figure it out. So I have a question for you.
Yeah.
I might have read the tweet wrong, but I was a little confused. There was an accusation against Erudite Kyla, who's like, I like her so much. I have a lot of respect for her. But the tweet was insinuating that she was like a pick me girl with like Destiny's crew. And then I think you retweeted something that said, I know. And I wanted to know what was the context of that, if you don't mind sharing.
So the tweet was about like in-grouping and like signaling in-grouping. And I think that Kyla does do this.
What's because in-grouping?
It's like, it's just being like, you know, I'm on your side, or like picking a side and then being like, okay, it's all of us against this one person because they're acting out.
Okay.
Everyone does this. It's very human.
Okay.
Everyone does this. I've done this. It feels good. It's very egoic. It feels good to be part of something.
Like you bullying people, but in a way that makes everyone feel like they're part of a team.
Yes. Cool. Yes. So when I had said something like, I made this tweet that was like, listen, I'm 24. I'm figuring my shit out. I don't have a hard stance on anything. Be nice to me. Not in a way that was like, be nice to me or else, but in a way that was like, come on, guys.
I do see you. Can I be honest? Cut me some slack. I do see you as like a kid sister who's like, I'm like, leave her alone. She's just figuring it out. Like
that is
with Sneeko.
Perfect.
Like, very passionate people, very sure. But you're like me. I feel like you end your sentences with a period. So it makes everyone think you're 100% sure. But it's just the way you talk.
I speak dogmatically, but I'm not in my brain. I'm 1,000 different places at once. I need to work on how to not do that. I don't know what it is that I'm doing that is making it so that that's not how it happens in my brain, but it's how it's coming out. I need to be more aware of it. I'm trying to figure out ways that I can be.
I'm 33. I'm still struggling with it, girl.
Yeah. So if you see me as a little sister, I want people to see me as a person who is learning with them. I don't want to posture like I'm above anyone. I don't want to posture like I know more than you or I know the prescription.
But you must know something I don't know, right? Because you have a lived experience I don't have.
Exactly.
So you're going to teach me stuff too.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. That's the only thing. I think I have as much to teach someone as someone has to teach me. That's why I go on Cozy TV and talk to these people who fucking hate Jews as a Jew. Right? Because I'm like,
you have so many more spoons than I do, girl. I'm so impatient. Like, you're so patient.
Because I'm just like, I'm not above you. I don't think I'm right. I'm not here to get like a fucking own on you. I just want to talk. I just want to have these Bohmian dialogues. But anyway, I made this tweet about like being like 24. I was like, be nice to me. In sort of like a LOL kind of like, it's not that serious sort of way. And Kyla goes, I said, I'm not like all these like 30-year-olds who have been solidified in these ideas. I'm still trying things on. And Erudite goes, I'm 28.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Who asked?
Wait, I read that tweet as I'm 28. Like we're both in our 20s. Like I'm still. Wait, I read that tweet wrong then. Because I heard.
Yeah, she was doing it in a way that's like, I'm 28 and I have everything. Like, I have solid positions. I'm like, okay, dude.
No, wait. I swear when I read, because I feel like I know Kyla.
I'll
I wanna
pull
ask
it up.
Because when I read it as like, I'm 28 and I'm still learning.
No.
Okay. We need to get Kyla on this live show.
No. I'll find it.
Because that's
find
how
it
I
I'll
read it.
It.
And but that's because I think Kyla is that person.
Let me find it. And then she said, Jesus fucking Christ, Lav, stop. Like, she was obviously signaling that, like, I was like, haha, stupid girl. Everyone was dogpiling. She was totally being a fucking pick-me. And that's she does this a lot with her, like, she's like, I won't call myself a feminist. I'm like, okay, Kyla, fucking get it together. Like, okay. She was like, I won't call myself a feminist. And then we were agreeing on like every single point about like egalitarianism. She doesn't want to call it feminism because it looks bad to men. I'm like, grow up.
Feminism does suck though. It's not very egalitarian. I'll fight you on that right now, girl. I worked with protesters. I worked in organizations. I raised money for these bitches.
I think it can be. But it's the same. It's the same thing. It's the same thing as like, it's why I don't understand non-binary, right? It's like, be subversive within the group. Be subversive. Change feminism.
Okay.
Change the way that feminism looks.
So that's the political brand. Just like with the sex work, like Genevieve, I don't know her yet, but I will get to know her. She feels like you are fucking with sex work the way that you feel Erudite's fucking with feminism.
Sure.
Right? So it's like you...
Don't make me empathize with her.
No, you... I'm going to encourage it, girl.
Let me be angry.
You can be angry, girl. Be angry. Feel your feelings. But like, that's the thing I want. I want people to really know that we're all doing the same thing for our teams.
Totally. I get it.
And like, we're doing what's best. Like, I love feminism. It was so good for me when I needed it. But then it started becoming toxic for me. So I left. And so I started leaving politics altogether because it didn't really help me. But you think I'm not going to pay attention to like politics when it involves my family or immigration or gay rights or abortion or any of that? Like, obviously.
Yeah.
So it can be difficult. This is the part of it that I think is so normal, though. We hear people say things, we get into fights, we go back and forth. But I want to know, does anyone really intend to change their mind? And if they do, are they okay with then changing themselves? Because our minds don't just change, our whole life can change. If we become a vegan, because we've changed our mind on meat consumption, that changes everything about us. How our farts smell, to how our gut health is, to how our family can eat with us. So are we open to the idea that we actually all basically are doing the same thing? We're just doing it differently?
You prove you wrong.
Yes.
Okay, this is the tweet succession.
Tell me.
I'm a 24-year-old streaming noob who is interested in politics and finding my voice. Give me a break. I'm learning. While I argue with all these 30-plus-year-olds who have had their political opinions for longer than I've used the internet. Be nice to me.
Okay.
Kyla says, I'm 28. I said, and don't you also get accused of being a fence-sitter? She said, not usually. Some people will dismiss me as a pick-me. I think potentially a difference in how people read us is that I try voicing my epistemic questioning. If I'm uncertain where I fall, I say that. So she
wants you to be, like, more...
She postured herself above me.
I can see that. I can see that energy. I can see that she's trying to say, I have a better way of doing it.
Yes.
Okay,
and also in that she's in grouping. I'm like, oh, me and Steven are on the same level. We're in the same whatever, and you're just like this kid who like knows nothing, and you're stupid. And I'm like, okay, maybe that's true, I'm not mad at Kyla for doing that. I think I would have done the same thing if I were her, but still, it's like it still sucks. And then she does that. And then she's like, don't use your mental illness, because I was like, I'm very mentally ill, but at least it's not BPD. In some ways, I feel like that is true. I shouldn't have said it. It was mean to say. I apologize.
Feel that way. Girl, I look at some mental illnesses. I was like, thank God I have borderline.
Yes. And it's not psychosis or something, right?
Oh, it's not.
But
like,
then especially when I'm talking to someone like Cherry and she's so like hypervigilant of everyone going to like wrong her, I'm like, fuck, thank God I don't have to deal with that stress. And that was in the thread.
Yeah.
And it was definitely mean. It was definitely mean. It was definitely a dig. But then she says, she was like, she said, Jesus fucking Christ, Lav, stop. You don't get to use your mental illness as an armor and then weaponize someone else's. And I'm like, armor? First of all, Cherry can use her BPD as armor. I know why she's like, her actions can be explained by her mental illness the same way that I'm explaining mine. I'm not taking that away from her.
Don't we all think we're better than everyone else though?
I don't.
I do. I think I'm better than everyone else but not in the way that everyone else does. I actually think I'm better than everyone else because I'm the only one living my life. So I have to think that. Like, not literally, but I think I've chosen the best path because it's the only path that works for me. Right?
It's interesting. I see people as so multifaceted.
They are.
That I know that, like, I'm better at some things than other people. And
I mean, Kyla is the best compared to me because in her bubble, she is doing the best. Like, she is... For her, like, look at her career. She's collabing with bigger streamers. She's doing all these professional gigs. She gets picked for Fresh and Fit. She is the best in that field, more than I am. Like, some people ask me, were you hurt that Kyla got to go to Fresh and Fit and you didn't. I was like, no, Kyla is so superior to me in this bubble. It would be a stupid idea to pick me to go there, because I just be like, ah, you guys are all in a bubble. Pass that shot. Like, I was just like, I wouldn't be as serious or professional. Oh. But Kyla is a professional. She's smart. She's educated. She's so much better at me. Like, being a professional, she is the best in her bubble.
In that facet.
Yes.
So me facet, you bubble is like the word switch. But like, yeah, I don't see that as like her being, when people are like better than, I think that intrinsically we all have the same value. So I don't like put myself above anyone. I do think that I'm like human to human, I'm a probably better musician than Kyla. Right. Yeah. But like that doesn't.
Well, that's what I think Kyla was. Okay. So if you want to play, the reason you're seen as like the younger and experienced person is because you are factually that person.
Yes.
So Kyla's giving you, though she's new to
streaming. She's reminding me of my place, which is the part that is icky.
Okay. I understand that totally.
Yeah. Because you think I don't know? I'm obviously, I'm obviously saying that in the tweet. I'm like, I'm so young. I'm kind of stupid.
You agree with Kyla, you just don't need to hear it from her.
Well, no, I agree with Kyla, but what I don't like is like the intentionality, because like I already had in that tweet been like, I don't know much.
So you felt I'm like being, she was like,
you. When I'm you showing admitted. Humility. I'm totally. Showing humility in my stomach. Mm-hmm. And she's like, and I'm posturing now. And it's like, mm-hmm. Why? Why do that?
We should ask her. We should ask her, because Kyla's such a wonderful person. There must be a reason. Maybe she was trying to unsolicited help. Maybe she was trying to put you in your place. Maybe. But I think that that's like the funny of it, right? Is like that might be, but this is so fixable. Don't be mad at Kyla over a tweet, right? Like, I want you guys to get along if you can.
I still really like Kyla. Okay, good. I still really like Kyla. Okay, good. I hope she likes me because I like her. I think that was like a little spit that we got into. I think that she has qualities where I'm like, come on, girl. You won't say you're a fucking feminist? Come on.
No, I'm a feminist.
Come on.
No laughs.
Same thing with you.
No. In the adult world, it means something very important.
Sure.
And if you identify as a feminist, you are picking a team, and I refuse to be on a team that doesn't fight for me. And feminists in the modern world do not fight for Britneys. They fight for people who align with their values.
Very different. So you could be a feminist who does, and then you can change
but
it.
I could also just be a Britney who does. Why do I have to That's be a true. Feminist? Right?
That's true.
So
That's
instead true. Of picking a team, because
but also when you denounce it is the problem.
I'm not denouncing
also.
Feminism, but I do think sex of feminism are trash, like some of the red pill communities.
Sure. But Kyla talks about it in a way that is like, I won't call myself a feminist because they hate men. And I'm like,
I think feminists hate men like red pillars hate women. In my opinion. I do. I think Fresh and Fit and feminists are like the same people. They just are on different sides of the coin. I do believe that because I've experienced it. But again, I protested. I'm sorry.
Maybe rad femmes. Like radical feminists. Sure. I'll give you that. A normal feminist is just someone who thinks that feminist? Men and women are equal. Let's look up the definition.
No, the definition doesn't matter because we're talking about.
Everyone's feminists. A feminist. Everyone's a feminist.
Well, that's like saying.
Unless you're a red piller.
Well, that's like saying like, because you know, there's like Orthodox Jews and modern Jews. Right? Would you say like everyone's an Orthodox Jew? Because like, no, but like you, if you looked up the definition of Jew, it's a religion and ethnicity.
Jewish people are, oh, I'm not Jewish because I don't wear a hat. They're going to be like, yeah, I'm Jewish. I'm just not like that fucking crazy type of Jewish.
Right. But then you wouldn't say you're religious Jewish. You're like, we always do this. We're like putting ourselves away. I'm not one of those sex workers. I'm not one of those Jews. I'm not one of those feminists. I'm not a feminist because I don't adhere to the political values of the party, nor do I agree with the definition of feminism if we're not going to just use egalitarianism. Like, what's the difference in that case?
Because
feminism is centered around and for women.
Women. But it's because it's needed. It's like the same thing about it's like Black Lives Matter, obviously, if like a women are an oppressed group, we're focusing on bringing females up to males in a way that is like egalitarianism makes sense, right? And that's beautiful. That's a beautiful sentiment. But when women are already down here and men are up here, it's like you need to focus. It's just it's centering focus a little bit.
Right. So I agree that in certain bubbles that is happening. I just don't think it's universally experienced in the same exact way. And so it makes it hard to want to jump on. And again, I've worked with feminist groups. I've protested. I've marched with BLM. I've marched with everybody. Mm-hmm. And there's not an agreement of what we're doing. And yeah, so because of true. That, owning the title makes it hard. So I'm not a Democrat. I'm not a Republican. I'm a registered independent. I just don't want to be assumed that I agree with like party lines. And there is a rule that in these groups you have to. I've been friends with so many feminists, so many queer people, so many. And they, behind closed doors, just like are very man-hating, very negative, very pro. Like, they don't believe in consent the same way I do. It's fine. But if owning that title associates me with these people, it doesn't make sense. So you know how feminism is centered around women and red pill is centered around men? Mm-hmm. I'm pro-men. So should I be a red piller and a feminist? Because men are at a disadvantage hugely in society by their own doing. Because men are stupid. And when they wrote the laws, they fucked themselves over as much as they fucked women over. So
still like the patriarchy. That's like still like against the patriarchy, which is affecting men also.
Totally. But also, I think that's my point is like, if you pick a side, you are hating each other.
I think I think I would call myself a feminist and like an MRA.
Okay. MRAs are different too. They have a whole thing they do. Okay.
My thing is that I'm hyper individualistic. I would like to be subversive in the group and change the definition of what the group is. Right. I don't like the law that is everyone in Black Lives Matter thinks this. Like, I have a Black Lives Matter sticker on my car. Mm-hmm. I would still call myself like a Black Lives Matter activist, mm-hmm. but I am not like pro prison abolition. I think that's retarded.
Right.
Right. Now, but like, that's their message.
Right.
Or
right,
a
right.
lot of the message. But I'm like, I don't need to believe that. I can identify with this group in some ways and really gun for it, but also be like, but let's have, you know, micro conversations within this that is like, we're just going to think differently.
I feel that.
And that's
fine. I
think
in politics, that's how it is most of the time. So outside of politics, when you go home and you have this personal belief, do the labels matter or is it just to communicate to people so they have an idea of who you are?
Marker. It's like a vague marker. I don't want that. I wish my hope is that I would, like, if I'm telling someone like, you know, I'm me, I'm a feminist, that they wouldn't immediately see me as like a type, right? I don't think that we should put people in like hard boxes.
Yeah.
I guess we do that to some extent.
It's just
like
so
naturally.
Natural. It's just so natural. Even me, so since I don't own a label, it makes people upset because they don't know where to put me. So now I feel dangerous to everyone because they're like, well, now I don't know what team you're on. And I'm like, I'm just on my team. It's a one person team. And when I get married, it's going to be a two person team.
Yeah.
I'm on my team. And then my inner circle's team is like, even my inner circle. Okay. So we all vote differently. My parents are anti-gay marriage, anti-abortion, anti-trans people. So like, you have to remember, I go home every like, you know, whatever to see my parents. And it's always like, the abortion thing. When the abortion thing happened, my mom was like, praise God, it finally happened. And I was like, and like, I get it. I love to kill babies. So I'm very pro-choice, but it is one of those things where I have to live in a reality where I share this earth with people who don't agree on reality with me, and we all have different opinions. So calling myself a certain thing, I think, is denying myself the way I really feel about it. So the only reason I denounced these labels eventually was because I just felt like they were still objectifying me by joining this group. Like, even sex worker is hard for me. I actually hate it, and I hate calling myself a YouTuber. But I have to because it communicates to people shorthand what I do, but I don't even think it really tells people what I do. So my sister, my family, my siblings, my boyfriend all go, man, I really forget you're a YouTuber. And I'm like, fuck. Because in my real life, nobody thinks of me as a YouTuber. So it's hard for me to think of myself as one. But of course, the world does. So when they criticize me, like when Max came at me, he's like, Brittany, you're a YouTuber. I was like, yeah, I know what you mean, but I'm not a YouTuber. Like, I'm not like, hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to my channel. Like the video. Like, I'm not a YouTuber.
Yeah,
but
we
are streamers. This is our talk radio. This is our chance to be, but we're not talk radio hosts like Sean Hannity or Rush Limbaugh who have like clicks and niches and ways to talk. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Does this make sense?
Yeah, no, it does. I get what you're saying. I think this goes back to my propensity to be like codependent. I think this is just like not trying to control everyone, but trying to like save everyone. And if like, you know, my mom's like a QAnoner, and every time we talk, I'm like, you need to, this is hurting you. Like, you're in a relationship that doesn't work for you. He hates you. Like, I'm like, I need to save her.
Yeah.
And like, that's not like. So like, if I'm, you know, if my parents were like against gay marriage, I would just be like, you know, this is hurting you. This might hurt other people. So it's like, I don't know. Maybe I'll lose that. Maybe that is just my propensity to be codependent and like save people from themselves, thinking that I have too much power. I don't know.
I mean, I went to therapy for it, so I get it. But like, I actually, yeah. I think that's why radical acceptance is so important to my brain, because I will panic if I think I'm in a room with people that think I'm like sinning or dangerous, because then I'll start thinking they're going to hurt me because they're misunderstanding me, which is why like Max can trigger me sometimes, because I'm like, do you really think I'm dangerous? Do you really think I hate Jews? Like, this is scary to me because like I'm Middle Eastern and I'm very confused about what's happening.
Like, God. Do you hate Jews?
No. They're basically my cousins.
That took you a really long time to say.
I don't know if I could hate a group of people. That's a lot of effort. That's a lot of effort.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah,
no, but like enough. Obviously my parents are super, they're Republicans, they're so pro-Israel, obviously. Like, I have so many, you know what's funny, I brought on an Israeli soldier once years and years ago who's trans. And my audience hated me because I had an SJW audience. And they're like, Brittany, Palestine. I was like, okay, so am I Middle Eastern, so I'm more Palestinian, or am I more Jewish? Because I think they're all kind of next door, right? So like, what do I do here?
Yeah.
Like, what do I do here? Everyone's going to be mad no matter what. So I feel like it's not, hating the whole group is not helpful. I know why we do it. Listen, this whole week, girl, if I told all of the male energy in my life, I'm sick of all of you today. I even told my boyfriend, I love you so much, I can't talk to you today. I cannot handle this male energy in my life because I was
same
so...
Same thing today. That is hilarious.
Well, I was rocked by the Amaranth loot news because I'm just like, even if it's true or not true, doesn't matter. I'm still impacted by the reality that this felt scary to me and similar to like the issues I have with my PTSD and stuff. So I was like, I need a day off where I'm very compassionate towards people who are in pain. And I can't have any logic answers of her husband was the reason she was even famous, or, oh, she brought this on herself. Like, that's... I can talk about that tomorrow. But today, I need full sympathy and empathy for a girl who possibly is being abused, even if it's not real. I just needed it, and I think that's my own mental health, like, you know, realizing I need that. But you don't always get that online, like you don't, like you don't. You know, and so it's not a place to get it. And so I know that I come to this internet to have a community that helps me explore ideas, but I am very blessed to have a community in my private life that can really be there for me when I have these moments and not take it personal. Obviously my family's like, cool, bro, we get it, you need space. I was like, thank you, I love you.
Yeah,
I thank you, I love you, because I know it's me, I know it's how I'm being impacted by the story. But I don't find that groups can often help. Like, when I was in my feminist groups, they were so helpful, but then when I started getting therapy and getting better, they didn't love that, and I got ghosted by all of them, and I don't talk to any of them. And then the couple that I do, they're not even in politics. They're just like normal people. And that's why I think they still love me, because they're not seeing me politically.
Yeah.
They're seeing me as a Brittany, and Brittany's got problems.
I think that's going to be my pivot is, I think the politics sphere is like really fun because it's so vivacious. And I love that because it is so vivacious, and I admire these people so much who are so smart and can argue. And I think that's a really admirable quality. I think we need so many people like that. And I'd like to be one of those people, but I think fundamentally I'm more of like a, like I, yeah, like you, like I just sort of like the philosophy of it. And I like having these discussions because they're hard and they're interesting, but I really am just like, I'm more of an empathetic person. I want to seek understanding.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I don't know. I think I'm going to pivot to more of like a, I don't know. I wanted to do the sex expert stuff. I want to do a lot of stuff like that, or like, I don't know. Maybe not like a guru situation, because God knows that I have not figured it all out yet.
Fair.
But I don't know. I more like personable, having harder conversations. Maybe I'll like reach out to more people who are like vastly different than me ideology wise and just have hard conversations.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think if you really tear, that's why I always, in my calls with people, we go over core work. We talk about the core, like what is the core in Brittany's world? I have a little, I don't know what to call it, experiment thing we do together. It's like a problem thing. Like I give them a scenario and then they give me answers and then we go through it and we talk about it. And it's like really lovely. And I think it really helped me. It's not going to help all people, but I think it really sets an identity for yourself. Like I had a caller the other day who had like this really great, like where like we could put it all together and be like, this is my archetype. This is my trope. This is actually what I want. This is actually not what I want. I had this girl. She was so one of my loveliest callers ever. We were talking about what kind of guys like are really, is she attracted to, like truly. And most people go with just the politics, but does anyone ever think about the aesthetic? Like, you have a very specific aesthetic. Not everyone's into it, but the people who are into it are really into it, right? Same with me. I'm not a generally attractive person to the populace, but if you're into my look, you're really into my look, and I appreciate that, you know? So when you're into that aesthetic, like, I think that that's what's so unique, is that past that, then there's the core of the person. But we use our physicality to express ourselves, and then sometimes we use it to distract from who we are. So finding out the differences is so hard. You're doing it. You're asking yourself, am I in sex work because I like it or because I feel like this is how I want people to see me? And then I don't think many people spend enough time doing that, but it's okay because most of the world, I think, functions. I know it's hard. I know it's not great, but it's never going to be. It never has been. So it's just what it is, right?
Yeah.
Do you accept that or no? You're very much,
I think it's funny because I think that it is so cool. I think that you get so much hate and I think that you're so cool. Like, I think that you've really like found, I think I admire you so much. You've found really like a niche to make yourself like really happy. And I don't know if you've read Eckhart Tolle, The Power of Now.
I haven't read it. I've watched a few of his videos. I'm looking to maybe read some of his books. I haven't actually read it.
You are so in that. Like, you are so, I worry because I'm so stuck in ego. And I see you as someone who is like, maybe still struggles with it a little bit.
I think.
But as someone who like has it more like, just like a person, you like really know who you are, what you want.
Yeah, that is true.
And I really, really admire that. And you're like not worried about other people. And I really need to not be worried about other people. So when I smile, it's not because I'm like, it's not because I'm like, oh, what's she saying? I'm smiling because I'm like, fuck, I wish I was like that. Like, I wish I could adopt that.
I appreciate that. It just worked for me. I don't want to assume, because like my friend brother's so happy in his bubble. He loves it so much. And I think that's lovely. And I think in mine, I needed to stop worrying about the world because I felt super obligated to save it. It was really destroying my psyche. It was really ruining me.
Me now.
Like, it's really bad. And so the thing I feel the most guilty about, or not guilty because that's kind of my values, but the thing I feel the most like, I feel icky about is like when I miss it, when I can't actually communicate. I think a part of me really wishes I could understand Max, but I feel like I can't see him, and so I can't humanize him very well. And I'm trying, but that's where my limitations come in. I can't actually, like it feels foreign. Like, I'm like, oh, I don't know what to do here. But I think that's the key. So I believe these gurus, like, who are like, I found peace and I'm never
angry. I think that you guys should have a talk and I should moderate it.
Do you think that? Do you think that would help? I only allow talks with Max if Steven is there. But I don't know. Maybe we need a different kind of moderators, or maybe both of you. I just feel like Max is such a unique person that I just don't understand, and I think that's fine. And I think because he can't see me either, he like had the audacity to like say things about me that like, hey, sir, which is weird because he was upset with Cherry for saying that about him. He's like, that could really hurt me. I was like, sir, Steven's Reddit page called me a Nazi for like 3 weeks.
Yeah.
And like literally sent me threats. What are you talking about? And threatened to take down my Patreon because they thought I hated Jews when I'm Middle Eastern. Like, I'm so confused at what's happening right now.
So I think I'm a middle ground between you two. Yeah. I think that Max is really stuck in ego. Mm-hmm. And not in a way that is like malignant, like that he like knows that he's doing something, it's malicious. Mm-hmm. I think it's because he's so hurt that he's like constantly stuck in ego. Because he's so frontal lobe, like thinking constantly, hyper aware of himself because of his mother and because of the abuse that he suffered, that he just like cannot see past that, and it makes him extremely reactive and very protective of himself. And also it gives him like the soapbox because he thinks that he has it figured out because he worked so hard to figure himself out, but he doesn't realize that maybe he has some holes in it, and so he has some holes when seeing other people too. The glasses that he's made for himself have they have holes in them. They're glasses that he made, right?
Like, it's not a collaboration, which is interesting because I know my reality was set solidified more, I think, in a collaboration with other thinkers because I don't trust myself to understand the world without help. But I understand myself with help, but not – the source isn't telling me who I am. I'm with the source collaborating to figure it out.
Yeah.
So I felt like my therapist, who was amazing, really collaborated with me to figure out why I was, you know, hanging myself outside of windows.
Totally. So this is the same. So imagine that feeling, because Max has felt the same thing with the abuse of his mother. Who am I? And he's also getting this like, oh, my mom's telling me I'm a bad person. So that he grows up with thinking, oh, I am a bad person. The only difference is that he's overcorrected.
I agree with that. That's actually... So I used to overcorrect as well. And I feel like my life right now is, I always tell my people, balance is everything, but you can't always be balanced. So I think that's the myth. You know, when you see these gurus who are like, I have found peace and I'm amazing. I'm like, girl, you've never been on a period. Girl, you've never been cheated on.
Totally.
Feel like it's a lie to think you're always balanced.
Yeah.
I think the truth is that we are all struggling, and we're struggling even when we're happy.
Yeah.
And it's a different struggle, though. Like, my inner peace is never shattered. I'm happy every day. I don't even remember the last time I messed with my depression. Like, I feel really good about that. That doesn't mean that I don't feel it creeping up sometimes, Lev.
Totally.
My borderline, it's like a sweet, big titty angel that hangs out behind me that's like, let's just be depressed. Let's be triggered.
Yeah.
And I'm like, shut up, bitch. And, like, I have all these intrusive thoughts that I deal with on a daily. So I'm always aware, but I think my sister said this. She goes, Brittany, you're just so confident that it makes me not want to sympathize with you. And I was like, fair.
I have the same problem. Yeah,
you do, girl. So here's the thing.
When you're
that trope or that archetype or you're that person, you have to almost, I had to force myself to like find the compassion, meaning to suffer with, for as many people as I could. If I can't see them, I can't. So I could be compassionate to myself, because I am that girl, and I'm a pretty badass bitch. I love my life. I control my life. I like pay my brother's rent. They better be grateful as fuck. Like, I do all these things. I still fucking cry at night. I struggle. I still get depressed. I still feel ugly. I'm still a fucking person, you know? And I feel like the people who really see you get to actually be there for you in those moments. So I'm really lucky. I have an inner circle. I'm lucky. I have an amazing partner who's so wonderful and can be there. But I didn't realize I needed that until I was like basically going to kill myself because of my stalker and online cancellation and Kiwi Farms. I legit couldn't handle it. Kiwi Farms fucking fucked with my psyche so bad. So I went to my family and I said, hey, the internet's really like, I don't know who I am. I'm freaking out. I feel like I should just die. And my family was like, no, you're not going to die because of some fucking trolls on the internet. And I was like, okay, but they think I'm a sex trafficker and I'm not. And I don't know how to explain to them that I'm not. And they're like, what? And they're like, okay, Brittany, this is crazy. Get off YouTube. But I can't laugh. I love this job. I love talking to people. So when coming into this, I had to accept that this was a part of it. But it is fucking hard to do this do this job. It is so hard to wake up every day and get messages from people. And you're like, that's not who I am. That's who they perceive me to be, because their bubble informs them that that's what I look like. And that's okay. Move them to the side. It's like a lot of coaching. I coach myself.
Oh, I don't know if you've seen Steven's subreddit.
Not lately, but I do check on it on occasion. Because like,
they do not like me. They do not like me at all. It is gnarly.
Okay, here's my theory, though. Once they got over who I was, some of them began to see me as a person, and I'm so grateful for those people. I think, generally speaking, his audience just doesn't understand some of the girls, but some of them are so lovely. Like, there's people in my chat right now that I recognize their usernames. I'm like, that's a Destiny fan. A lot of my callers are Destiny viewers. They're so lovely. So they, like, a big part of his audience is lovely, but the ones who go ham on Reddit and have conspiracy theory personalities, girl.
Yeah, I've gotten to the point where, like, I still read it and I'm like, this person doesn't understand me. That's fine.
They don't.
Yeah. It's still, like, it still hurts, though, to read, right?
Yeah.
And totally. Especially with my propensity to self-abandon, I'm like, what if they're right? You know what I mean? I mean,
literally, I'm borderline. So, girl, it's like, oh, shit.
Yeah, so I'm like, oh, fuck. Like, maybe I am doing this. I think to some degree that's, like, why Cherry's criticism hurt so bad. Because I was like, fuck, like, maybe I am manipulative. That's my first conversation with Max. I don't know if you ever saw it. I self-abandoned so bad. Mm. I like let him call me an abuser. And I was like, fuck, I am an abuser. I have abused before. No, I haven't.
That's the gaslighting thing that Max does that really bothers my brain. Because I'm like, I didn't do this. And so it feels very strange. Like, I'll back up Max.
Imagine being in that brain, though.
Ugh.
Imagine being in that brain, because you have to that's a learned behavior.
Yeah.
Who did that to him so often and so fervently that that's the way that he thinks now? That's exhausting. I think that he can change. I really can. And I also think that he's having an ego death right now because of everything that's happening.
All people can change. I believe that.
So I think that in the next couple of weeks, he would be probably the best to talk to you because he's having this like this new like, oh, fuck, I've been trying to get Dr. K removed and then I got banned sort of thing. Right. Like he's sort of like.
Oh, do you think he's going to actually realize like it sucks?
I hope so.
That would be interesting. I'm open to having a conversation with Max and you and maybe Steven if he wants to be there or whatever. I just want it to be a real conversation. Like, yeah, hey, bro. Because if I wake up tomorrow and my YouTube channel is gone, if you don't think I'm going to cry, like, that is just... It's happened to me totally. Once. I got false flagged once, and I got my channel taken down. And thank God I was friends with bigger YouTubers at the time who were so nice and reached out for me. But, like, oh, my God. Like, it was awful. And I couldn't... I reached out to Sneeko, too, and I said, I'm so sorry your channels are gone. Like, that is devastating as a YouTuber who's, like, kind of artisty. And, like, I feel like that way about my work. Max feels that way. Sneeko feels that way. It's devastating. So I really feel for him in that regard. And that's the thing. I want to be able to back him up. I want to be able to say, get Mr. Girl's channel back. But then if people ask me, but do you like him? Do you agree with him morally? It's like, well, no. But, like, that doesn't matter to me. But, like, I understand. Like, I can dislike Max, but, like, still not think his channel should get taken down. You know? So I think it's just hard because, no, I don't know. It's like I can't tell if he's just, like, self, like, what's this called? Like, self-fulfilling prophesying himself.
He's looping.
He's, like, you know? And I'm just, like, stop doing it. Just stop doing it. Stop assuming or stop being surprised. Like, he tried to be a provocateur and then was surprised that the world was upset. It's like Marilyn Manson in the 90s being like, why are you upset? And it's like, bro, like you're, but they should be there. They should do that. I think society needs people like Max. Society needs Marilyn Manson. But I don't think because they're healthy for society, I think they are the unhealthy thing that forces society to consider how healthy they are. So I don't know if you agree with that, but I do think Max is pretty toxic. I just think that he's lovably toxic.
I think
toxic.
He is too. I mean, I feel the same way about Cherry. I'm like, should we allow this person with the platform to like encourage all these people to also be unhealthy? Right? I'm like, probably not. But I'm not ever going to advocate for deplatforming ever. Yeah. It's like, I'm just gonna add my voice so that hopefully it like counteracts in some way, right? But
it's the same thing with religion. Like I, Brittany, am super. See, that's hard to say. Legally, I'm super pro-religion. Like, emotionally, I feel like religion is a choice, and it's not the choice that I would make for my family.
Yeah.
But because I was raised in it, and it didn't fulfill me as a person. But then my other siblings were really fulfilled by their religion, and it was everything they needed to feel joyful. So I can't take it away from them.
Yeah.
Even if I think, as a Brittany, I'm not going to raise my kids with religion because I think it's damaging. It's only really damaging if you don't fit the bubble of the religion. But if you fit into the bubble, it's perfect for you. So that's kind of what's scary. Is Max picking a bubble that's actually perfect for him? Or is he in one that's not perfect for him?
I think he self-harms constantly.
Do you think by posting, you mean, or by being online?
Yeah, I think he does. I see these patterns because I do them. Especially, I saw it especially with the sex doll review. Holy shit. He was like, but I gave you guys all of me. Why didn't you like it? He knew. He knew that he was being a provocateur. He knew.
Did he give us all of him? That's the thing. It felt like he was always tricking. Like, it always feels like Max is not giving me everything, which is why I feel uncomfortable with him. Because I feel like he's... But then again, when I'm with Max, he could... Like, when I talked to you for the first time in that screaming match, whatever... Mm-hmm. I can understand that I was holding back because I felt like none of you deserved me because none of you asked for me. You asked for the version of Brittany that you saw. So I got super like, I'm high. I'm enjoying my night. I don't fucking need to do this. But that's not the truth of what I want. Actually, I would love if somebody was actually interested in me. I think Kylo has been. Like, Kylo really reached out. Speak of the devil, she just messaged me. Kylo really reached out to me, and she really asked me questions about myself. And I really appreciate that because I know I'm weird. Girl, I know. Why does Max know he's weird? Do you think you're weird? Because you know you're weird, right? Okay, just checking. Just want to see how sane you really were.
I know I'm weird. I know I'm stupid. I know, I know all these things. But yeah, I think Max knows. I think that it's really embarrassing also to be, first of all, a man. a man in your 30s and to admit that you're flawed. Mm-hmm. I think that there's a lot that goes into that. True. I think that women are allowed to be a little more neurotic than men are. And I think that
True.
Max is neurotic in a very feminine way.
Ooh, I agree with this.
So I think that that's even more embarrassing, potentially. Not that it's more embarrassing, like, actually, but that he probably feels that way. And so I think that he protects himself, especially against women, especially against strong women, right? So I think that this is why he has, you know, an issue with Kyla. Why he's had an issue with you. I think that he's already going into
Stardust,
it with, like, a
clenched. Everybody.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that he is very low in agreeableness, but very high in openness. Which is a really interesting, dichotomy.
Yeah, wait, you're onto something. Which is interesting, because on politeness, I'm like a 7 out of 100, but on openness, I'm like a 90-something.
Yeah.
But with agreeableness, I don't know, actually. I don't remember. But, like, that's interesting. He is, yeah, wait, he's a, what's that thing you have in your brain where you're, it's defiant behavior or defiant disorder. It's like when people
but
say
ODD, things. Oppositional defiant disorder.
Yeah, do you think he has something similar to that, or no, that would be too extreme?
No, I don't think that. I think that what he is dealing with genuinely, and I've said this a billion times, is a deep narcissistic wound. Mm. And I think that when you're close to someone who's a narcissist, you end up mirroring a lot of that behavior. Mm-hmm. I don't think that he's a narcissist at his core. I really don't think so. I think he probably worries about it, though. Like, I think he worries about it, and I think that he overcorrects with that. I think he's really stuck in that ego. I think that he's constantly trying to figure out who he is, what he's trying to save the world. He's trying to do all these things. He wants the truth. He's like a truth seeker, but he has to be like, it has to be like the truth, and everyone has to see that it's the truth, and he wants to pass it off in a palatable way.
That I see in a few people that I usually say is like, okay, what's this mental illness? Like,
it's unstable. It's a narcissistic wound. It's when someone is telling you who you are for most of your life and you are not able to build a solid identity and foundation. Or you really admire that person and they're telling you that you're this way and you know it's incompatible with who you are, but you're self-abandoning and you're being like, oh, maybe that is what I'm doing.
Isn't that interesting? Because when I got diagnosed with borderline, people were like, oh, who's the narcissist in your life? And I was like, what? They're like, people who are borderline have narcissistic parents. I was like, my parents aren't narcs. I know what narcissists are. I read the books. And I was like, oh, but wait a second. And then I started thinking, it's not my parents. It's somebody else. And I was like, are they? But then it's not that. My therapist is very confident that it was the gay thing that my parents told and said a lot that I was like, not gay, not gay, not gay. Even now, my mom goes, Betsy, please.
Yeah.
So it's not, they don't do it because they're narcs. They're just doing it because they genuinely don't think I'm gay or don't think I'm a nudist or don't think I'm these things. So they're like waiting for me to be healthy.
Yeah.
But they also,
well, it's also a spectrum. It's also a spectrum, right? Like I think that you're someone with BPD who is like, not salvageable, but you're someone with more like self-awareness. So you might be like, you're not as deep in the hole as a lot of people who will never come to the same conclusions that you have.
That's
right?
True.
There are some people who will stay sick, right? Yeah. I think that me and Mr. Girl are on the same narcissistic wound spectrum. Mm. And I'm sort of just like a little bit I'm like a little closer to being like, okay, I'm a little more self-aware. Maybe it's because I got help when I was young. Maybe it's because someone did like save me, right? But, you know, if you're Max and you're also a man, people don't take mental health seriously for men. People don't do the same things that I was coddled after I had a narcissistic mother by my grandma who was like, I needed to save her. He might not have had that, like, you know, correction of empathy and care.
Wait, that's so totally true, Laugh. Because, listen, as a higher functioning borderline or whatever my therapist called me, I realize now that I look back, I feel like a lot of my borderline or a lot of my issues is around people not seeing me. And then I panic because I'm like, okay. Mm-hmm. But my parents love me. It's like, there is no doubt my parents wanted to have 10 kids, that they love us all, that they're such good people overall, that I just know they didn't mean to do it. It was so accidental. And I accept that my borderline is now because of an accident.
Yeah.
Which is so fucking weird.
And then, there's that. And then there's people like Max has publicly said that like he was kicked out because his mom was like, I'm scared. I want to have sex with you. That's imagine that.
I could not.
And then saying that, like, it's your fault. And it's your fault that I want to do this.
I could like, never. I would
imagine that would fuck with you.
That's why I reached out to him. When I heard that story, I was like, this man has been through it. But even though I was feeling so for him and I met him, we just can't, I can't.
Well, imagine also, I think that you also really wanted to see him and you wanted to show him. And I made the same mistake because the first time I called and I was like, I see you and I see that you needed Steven to protect you against Kyla in that conversation. That was the first thing. They had a conversation. I was like, I saw how lost you were. Mm. And I want you to know that I heard you and that, like, I get where you're coming from.
But that's, like, first thing I said to him. That's the difference is you feel very confident. You see him and you probably do. I still don't think I can.
But no. But you wanted to.
I wanted to. Yes, for sure.
Yeah. So wanting to and me seeing him are the same thing to him because he's like, no, I know who I am now. Nobody else gets to tell me. No one else gets to... he's overcorrecting. No one else gets to tell me who I am. No one else gets to be inside my head because he had someone in his head for fucking years. He's like, I'm the only person allowed in my head right now.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense to me. I hope he finds a quiet space to figure out who he is.
He will not. And he certainly is not right now. Can you imagine also dealing with all that trauma, all that mom sexual trauma, and then getting accused of something like this? He cried on stream. He cried on stream.
Really?
I had to keep it together. Wait, on your call together? Yes.
Oh, the first call you guys did?
No. On the call yesterday, I think.
Was he crying? I didn't even notice. I'm such a bitch. Yes. I wasn't really watching the screen.
Yes, he cried. I'm like, how the fuck are you guys getting mad at me for being as mad at Cherry as I am? Mm. When Max is like, he's at his fucking lowest and Cherry's like, no, I'm not taking it back. I do think you sexually harassed me. What the fuck, bitch? Like, maybe this is my codependent propensity. I went into, like, mom mode. I know that we joke that Max is, like, my stream dad because he's older than me and I was birthed from him.
Yeah.
But in that moment, I was like, I don't know. I was like, in that moment, I was like, Max needs a mom. And maybe that was me being unhealthy and maladaptive and feeling like I could save him. But I was like, I'm going to let one person know that Max has someone in his court. I don't care how fucking bad it makes me look, which I shouldn't have done that.
Is that just like the connection you feel to him that makes you feel like you want to be there for him
It's me. I wish someone would do that for me. It's me.
Aw, girl.
Yeah.
What the hell? You got a fiancé? What's that?
He's like that in a lot of ways, but also I think he reminds me of my mom a lot.
God. Okay, wait.
If you gave me too much attention, I wouldn't be interested. So I'll be going over that in therapy.
There you go. I have a question for you. How are you doing with spoons and energy? And should we invite Kyla into this conversation? Not that she's available, but if she is available, do we want to do that?
Sure.
Let me ask her if she's free. No guarantees. And then while she's coming on, I gotta pee like a fucking racehorse. You free to come on stream with Lev and I, because I think like you're in such a, like, I love your energy right now. I am in a good space. I figure like, let's just have that conversation about that tweet, girl, because I kind of want to know.
Sure.
And I figure this is like a great, like, hey, when you have these moments in real life, don't worry, we're gonna do it on stream right now so you guys can figure out how to do it in your lives if she's free. If she's free. Okay, let me pee while she gets back to me. Entertain the stream.
Like, I also need to pee.
Oh, perfect timing.
This is great. Oh my gosh, that was so funny. Women don't go to the bathroom together in groups challenge impossible. That is the funniest thing. Oh my gosh. I hope I didn't just flash everyone. That would have been horrible. Is there anything common between them? Yes, we are both incredibly beautiful, hot, sexy women. One has to pee, other one has to pee too. They're women, they get in sync. True. I would say after the startup and carry accusations, if they can't understand, navigate this space, they shouldn't be in it. Ew.
That was literally the longest pee of my life.
Mine was quick.
Oh, that felt so good. I've been drinking this hibiscus tea all day, and it's so good. And I just want to keep drinking it and drinking it, but then you got to pee like a racehorse all fucking day.
Caffeinated or
say that again?
Is it decaf?
It's just, I don't know. If you buy it regular, is it decaf? No.
I don't know. I really like tea. I really like tea, but I can't have caffeine. So I've been like trying to like a good tea. No, I have a heart condition.
No, really? You know what I just found?
Even chocolate fucks me up.
Shut up. What do you do on your period?
Die? Cry? No. Salt? I have a lot of salt.
No. Oh, that's so interesting. See, that stuff, we love tea, we love caffeine in this house, but I just found these amazing, like, energy shots with, like, 100 milligrams of caffeine and like 10 milligrams of weed. And I'm like, bro, it's like the best of both worlds.
I would die.
Left. I was literally like, yeah. I was like, oh my God, I do not need this. I do not need extra caffeine. I didn't know it was going to hit me so hard. I don't take energy shots ever. I was literally like bouncing off. I was ready to take over the world.
It's like a tiny Four Loko. Yeah.
Literally. I was crazy. I was like, I'm into this. Whatever this is my thing.
That is horrifying.
Okay, so Kyla hasn't gone back to me. I don't know if she's... I don't know. I almost want to be that bitch and just call her and be like, bitch, get on the internet now.
You should.
Get on. How do we add people to calls? Like, how do we even do that? Don't we have Do you know how to do it?
No.
I think you... I'm on... Hold on. I think it's this.
Create? Do you create?
Add friends to DM.
Create group DM. Create group DM.
Create group DM. Where is she? Like, girl, get on the internet. She just messaged me. Girl, get on. Get on the interwebs. She's probably busy. She has a real life. This girl leaves her house. You know Kyla leaves her house?
I have never done that. So.
I get my groceries delivered. That's how dedicated I am to never leaving my house.
Yeah, no, me too, literally. No, like actually me.
I feel so much. I just love my house. I'm so lucky. I love, I hope they rent to me again next year. That's always the nervous part when you find a good rental.
Oh, dude, yeah.
And then they don't rent the next year. You're like, girl. Man, I don't know how long I'm supposed to wait for her. She's probably busy. She's probably living a real life.
Maybe.
How do you feel after this call? How is it different talking to me versus those panels, girl? Because I could not. Those panels give me acne.
Well, I think that there's obviously, like, there's something really beautiful in, like, a feminine conversation where we're not trying to dominate each other in the way that men do.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I think that it's great to be, like, a guy's girl and to, like, hang out with the guys. Totally. But it is so refreshing to talk to a woman.
Yeah.
Like,
I just think
it's so different.
Yeah, it's exactly what you just said. I love talking to the boys. I love being in my man space. But like sometimes I'm just like, I need feminine energy and only feminine energy.
Yeah, totally. So it's much better.
Good. I feel like you're more well, I think we give each other the space with just the two of us versus in a panel. You know, I got invited to a few panels, but I was like, I don't know what I'm doing here. I don't debate, I don't move people in my direction, I don't care. So why don't I want to in the future form a panel. I have my sex worker friends who are like escorts and stuff. I want to have a panel for sex workers, but I thought, what if we have like a couple non-streamers as well? And then we have a couple of streamers. That way we're not like that way we can formulate like a real conversation maybe. And maybe if I host it, it'll be a little different. You know, so if you're interested in something like that, I'll reach out to you. But I would love to have your voice involved, right? Because I feel like your experience, your lived experience is a real experience for people.
Yeah.
And I just feel like, why aren't we talking about all of the good, the bad, the ugly, everything?
Totally. Totally.
Like, what are we going to lose?
Yeah, totally.
Are you good on that stripper pole, by the way?
Yeah.
Girl, I suck. I'm so weak. I can't put myself up. I can get to the top of the pole if I use all the strength in my body and then I'm dead for the rest of the day.
Really?
I don't know if it's just the lupus because like I'm dying right now, but I don't understand how people do the pole. It's so hard. It's like fucking athletes over here.
You have grip?
I have the grips thingies, and then my friend even, she's a stripper, recommended gloves she has and she uses.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But I think it's me. I think my body just isn't strong.
Well, my body is not. I can't even. I did volleyball for like years and years and years. Could never overhand serve. That's how weak I am.
Okay, but so, at least you played a sport, girl. Yeah, right. Like I skateboard. I was like on a skateboard, falling on my ass every day. That's my version of sport. So at least you did a sport.
Okay, fair enough. I also think it's because even now I've lost a lot of my muscle definition after my heart surgery because I just like wasn't working out. But it's mostly just about like technique. Have you ever taken a class?
No, but I do subscribe to a course done by her name is Sammy. I forget what her last name is. She's an amazing dancer. And so I've been using her exercises and stuff, but I haven't gone to that advanced part of it. I think that might be a part of it.
So,
technique, none.
So it's conditioning is a big part of it, but also technique, learning where to like hold your body is like 90% of it. Because I couldn't invert until finally I was like, oh, I'm inverting with the wrong muscle.
That's it. It's got to be it. Because I just feel like I feel like a person trying to ride a bike on the pole. I'm just like, what is this? What is happening? Why can't my body look as cute as these girl bodies? I don't get it.
Also, there are some people who are just like naturally more graceful. I don't think I'm there. I'm not graceful. I think I do okay. But there are some bitches who get on the pole and they look like they're swimming. That is not dancers.
I'm just sitting here. I'm clunky, girl. I'm a clunky. Yeah. I try to be cute. I try to dance, but I feel clunky.
I saw the video that you posted earlier on Twitter. You looked very graceful and beautiful. So you could have fooled me.
That's the height of it, girl. That's my 100%.
You're like, that was the 18th take.
It gets no better than that. I went on YouTube. Explain this to me. I went on YouTube. I was like, how to shake ass. And literally, it was all people with no ass. I was like, okay, guys, I need to learn how to do this like circle thing girls do with their butts. I'm obsessed. I just want to do it all day. But I was like, what's the technique? And there's like, why aren't there more videos on the internet from girls with butts teaching you how to move your butt? Where are they all? Blums. I just don't get it. Like, where are they all? I don't get it. Wait, what did you say?
I said white woman problems.
Okay. I'm telling you, all these girls in the videos were not ethnic enough to be teaching these classes.
Oh, I know. Believe me, I've Googled the same exact thing.
What is this?
Yeah.
This is not good.
Yeah, absolutely. But you should take a maybe even just one like in-person class just so they can like be like, this is the muscle you use, point to it, and then that would be the biggest thing.
So smart. Actually, I've only done one pole class, but it was not for strippers, which I want to learn how to do. It was for this place was lovely, no shit, but like, okay, I went to this class for a strip class, and like I thought it was a strip class, a pole class, whatever. They go, we don't have mirrors in this room. I was like, why? They're like, because we're not here to judge how we look. I was like, no. That's exactly what I'm here for. I want to learn the technique of how to look sexy on a pole. And I don't mean sexy by your subjective standards. I mean sexy by, like, the standard. And, like, they weren't about it. They're like, oh, we're all perfect. Everyone's good, no matter your skill level. And I was like, I need a coach. Yeah, I need a coach who's like, no, this is how you do it. Just like you said, I need one of those people.
Yeah, that's so interesting. I had an eating disorder for like 14 years. I started very, very young and I had body dysmorphia. There is nothing that reconnected me with my body like pole dancing. Like nothing. That's beautiful. Nothing.
Did sex work for you?
No, not much. Not by much.
Okay, because I think it does it for me. Sorry, I was just thinking about that correlation.
Yeah.
I think being naked makes me, for you, pole.
Oh, dude, because I'm seeing my body move. I'm seeing the way I'm like falling in love with how, it brings me from like point A to point B, how strong I can be. It made me feel like, oh, my body's, because so much of my life, especially being a woman, you're like very posed.
Yes.
So like, and the way that you even look in the mirror, you're like sucked in, you do your little face, you do whatever. And you can't do that when you're polling because you're looking at yourself be uncomfortable and messy and whatever. Yes. And then I started to see myself not as myself, but as another person that I started to fall in love with outside of myself. I was like, oh, she's very beautiful. She's trying her best. She's trying hard. And so then I was falling in love with the only way I could fall in love with myself was by disconnecting from myself first and then reintegrating.
Okay. When you do sex work, when you post a picture, do you think like this is me and I'm posting it, or do you post it thinking like that bathtub photo was like I liked it?
A character, yeah.
Is it like what is it for you? You know what I'm saying?
It's not me.
It's not you.
No.
What is it?
I don't know. It's like an alter ego. Yeah, it's who I'd like to be. I think I'm very awkward and weird and autistic. And so I think it's a really nice thing to be like, oh, I'm this hypersexual dominant woman, when like at, you know, with my fucking fiance, I'm just like, I'm like vibrating constantly. Yeah. Also extremely anxious. So I feel like a fucking, that's why I feel like being dominant, being a bit of a sadist has actually given me a lot of power back, because usually I'm like very anxious. So then I get to play this character and it's actually very healing for what it is.
Okay. So that's really interesting to me. Not to be gay again, but in gay circles, like drag queens, performers, burlesque, it's so much about the individual performing and so much about the confidence you feel, the control you have over your body. Yeah, right? So for me, that's how I want and continue to explore sex work or expression is I want to feel like in control of my body. I haven't been able to work out. I just got permission to do body workouts, which is really great. It's better than nothing. I lost all my – any definition I had is gone. Like any version of me working out is gone, but that's okay. Mm-hmm. I've cried enough about it. But It's about being in control of my body and feeling powerful. Like being able to say, look at what I'm capable of. I think that's why people like athletes are so amazing. Dancers are so amazing. It's like, look at the way they're moving and in control. I'm so klutzy. I like fall over everywhere. So if I can get even a 15-second clip of me actually like standing still and not, some girl, sometimes I'll be just standing and I'm like, whoop. And I'm like, my ankles will give out and I'll fall. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? It's just like, so for me, it's all about that. You know, what am I actually capable of? So I know my own limitations.
Yeah.
You know, sex work is like my version of Boy Scouts. It's like, yes, you can survive in a forest, but can you survive on a pole?
Interesting.
I want to know if I can survive naked, vulnerable, open, without ever really sharing myself. Like my partner sees a version of myself that nobody gets to see ever. But people pretend they want to see it, but they don't, because it's all the vulnerabilities. It's all the insecurities. And online, I think I show some of it, but I really love being confident and exploring that version of myself online. Like I dress up more for my streams than I do in person in my real life.
I think you're a tester. I think that's a big part of BPD. I think you test yourself and you test the people around you, probably because you have been very fearful of like you have your little toe out testing people and trying to test the water.
You know, I thought I was spontaneous my whole life, and then I realized I am not spontaneous. I'm just a tester. Yeah. So to everyone else, it looks like Brittany's doing crazy. She's just whatever she wants to do. Yes, but also because I'm like, oh no, this one. Like I've been without money. I've starved. I've done all these things. And I think every time it was almost like, can I get through this? Can I do this? Can I live without a house? Can I live without?
Yeah. And like, it's like agility. You're like agility testing yourself and everyone.
Totally. Totally. And I want to say not to like, you know why? I think it's important for consent to negotiate, to know the self, to tell people, this is what I want from our friendship. This is what I can give you. This is what I'm capable of. If you don't know yourself, how are you going to like really negotiate your own consent?
Yeah. Right?
But to figure it out, you got to fuck up a few times, get into some toxic relationships, maybe hurt yourself, maybe hurt other people. It's just a part of life. To know the self is to question everything about the self. You know, I have such confidence in these things, but what if, when put to the test, how capable am I? You know, I just want to know so I can tell people, I'm really strong. I have a great personality. But hey, when it comes to this, I'm not so great.
Yeah.
You know, just so they can really consent to what they're dealing with. You know, I try to give people 1,000 outs, 1,000 out of friendship, 1,000 outs out of love. I'm like, just leave if you're going to make my life harder, please. But I can't know how to communicate that unless I know myself.
I think that's interesting because I think that that's a adaptive behavior that we do to keep ourselves safe. And it seems like you didn't feel that safe around your family, even though they loved you. But, no, you know, grow.
Yeah.
Probably feel.
No. That, internalizing all of that, all the things I said about gay people, internalizing everything they said about, like, people around me. As a small child, just, like, looped it in my head. Like, am I a predator? Am I a pedophile because I'm gay? Like, I'm so confused. And then eventually I realized, like, okay, no, this is this bubble. And then I met my friend who's a liberal and grew up Democrat. And then I got to go into that bubble where she had a gay aunt. And I saw her aunt have babies. And I was like, okay. Yeah. So gay people aren't just this way. Like, I remember when my cousins invited me to babysit their kids after I came out. And I was like, you trust me around children? They're like, yes, Brittany, gay people aren't pedophiles. I was like, not what I heard growing up. And then my parents finally changed their minds and said, okay, it's not that gay people are pedophiles. It's just the ones we knew growing up were pedophiles. So we thought everyone who was gay was a pedophile.
Interesting.
Yeah, they just that was their lived experience. So how could they not be fearful, right? Who wants a fucking pedophile kid? That's my biggest fear. I'm trying to, you know. By the way, Kyla said she's free in 10 minutes. You down?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Let me message her. And that's perfect.
We have to figure out how to do a 3-way call. Hopefully she knows.
We might have to hang up and start a chat. So let me see. It says I can add her to this call, though. So let me see. And I think it makes it automatically a 3-way. Love me a threesome. Why? Are we not friends on Discord? I'm going to send you a friend request, and then if you add me, I think then I can add Kyla.
Oh, yeah. That's strange that we weren't.
Yeah. I thought we were, but maybe we just messaged each other. Okay. And then Kyla is Erudite. Here she is. Create group DM. Oh, but you disappeared from my screen, so I have to do a pop out. And I have to add it back in. I'll just make it full. Wait, which camera? You're seeing me on that camera. So what I'm going to do, hold on, guys. Okay. Why is it so elongated? Oh, and she's not here yet, so we won't be able to really fix this. Okay, we'll fix this when Kyla gets here so I can really see what the dimensions are going to be. I'm going to turn off my DSLR here and turn it on here. If that will work. Ooh, CM with the super chat. Thank you so much. Woo, girl stream. Yes, ma'am. Okay, did that? Why am I black here? Oh, because yeah, I ruined you left the me. Stream. I did. Hold on. I'm learning technology is very hard for me. I'm a very special person. Okay, I might just have to do it this way. Do-do-do-do.
Want.
That's fine. Want. I'll just do it this way. Meh, 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 meh. Meh, 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 meh. Yeah, and then we'll wait for Kyla. I wonder, I almost want to get a snack.
Yeah, I was just about to say that I'm going to get a little.
Okay, let's go get, like, let's just go get a snack. I'll be right back.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Perfect. I'm going to tell Kyla, getting a snack. Getting a snack. Join whenever. You will be streamed, though. Okay.
Hello. Hello, chat. I don't know if you guys can hear me. I'm looking at Lav's chat. More girl stream. Okay, I'm looking at Brittany's chat now, too. Can you guys hear me just while they're away? I'm just going to voice mic check. And I got a new rig today. Just setting up, so I want to make sure everything's working. Okay, as you see, just showered. Okay. You can hear me, Kyle. Thank you. This wouldn't be a thing in a guy stream. Are they getting snacks? It looks like they're getting snacks. Oh, yeah, yeah. They said that in the Discord chat. Hi. I just showered, as you can see. Yep. Actually a Sikh, yeah. It's just a satin towel. Yeah. Fresh and clean. No, not even deodorant on yet. Hi, Postal. Nice emote. Yes, sound good. Oh, hello, Jacobus. Oh, hi, Clean. Hello. I think she can hear me yet.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
I am super good. How are you?
Good. How fun is this already? We were Lav and I were like, bro, I'm hungry. Let's go get a snack, though.
I know. Somebody was like, this would never happen in a dude-only stream.
Hey, you know, a girl gotta eat. A girl gotta eat.
It's a very femme thing of just being like, guys, snacks.
Snacks. Okay, I'm so excited. Oh, it's so nice to see you. You look cute. What is this headscarf we have going on, fashion queen?
It's just a hair towel. I think my mic's cutting in and out, though. One second.
A little bit, yeah.
Drop it down. Is my mic too loud at all? Like, is it, like, booming?
You guys tell me. Guys, how is she sounding? Because I can control... I can control you from my end too, though, right? Like, I can click on you personally.
Clicking, you can.
Clicking. I think it's fine. Let me know, guys, if I need to move anyone up or down.
Yeah, some people are saying I'm loud. Usually I turn my Yeti down to 85% because it tends to boom on
the Discord. Well, okay, I don't know if my Yeti's going to be better, but I got a little microphone stand for it, so I'm hoping this is better. My mic is quiet.
Oh. The boom arm. I think it's the same boom arm I have. It looks the same.
Yeah, I think so. Wait,
I think yours is longer.
Well, girl, you know what they say. I, you know, that's a penis joke.
Sorry, I missed it. I got distracted. I missed the really penis quiet, joke.
So I'll just turn down Kyla. So we're even on my end. Okay, try now. Kyla, talk at the same time. Talking, we're talking check, at the same
check,
time.
Check, check,
so now one, you're really two, quiet.
Check, okay. check, 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 1, 2, 3.
Okay, who's check, louder, check, me or check. Kyla? Because I can't lose to a white woman, so.
True.
Get my card revoked. She's a little loud. I think that's an old comment. You guys say it. Wait, was there fuzzy mic cover? Oh, I got rid of my fuzzy mic cover because it was too big and distracting. I loved it, though. I had this furry mic cover for my Yeti, and girl, I just wanted to like rub my face on it like a cat.
So yes. Good. I think we have the exact... Did you get all this from Amazon?
Because yeah,
I also
did.
Had a furry. Okay, yeah. We have the exact same setup. I also had a furry thing, but then it was just like too much fur in my mouth all the time.
Oh, yep. So yep.
I went for the more traditionally phallic look instead.
Okay, how's that, guys? What's weird is that they're hearing us sort of similar. You're a little louder, but I turned you down again. And then I'm hearing you quieter now. So I'm too low. They're too low. Everyone's too low.
I turned my mic down a little bit as well. So,
boomer stream. Okay, guys, is that... Well, Lav will come and then she'll ruin the whole fucking thing and then we'll have to do it again.
Yeah, she's going to be like booming loud comparatively. Hello. But she doesn't have a Yeti. Oh, your sound is perfect for me.
Hello, hello, hello. Why am I so low? Hello? I'll just talk quiet. What the fuck? Is my game too
low? The rest of the stream.
Hello?
The rest of the stream will just be this. I ruined everything. I should just leave.
No, stop. Okay, guys, tell me again. Do I really sound too low? Okay, y'all are pretty similar. Now you are too quiet. Fuck. It's pretty balanced now. Oh.
It doesn't sound like your voice is coming out of your mic. It sounds like...
Let me see if it picked up the wrong mic when I switched everything over. It did. Fuck yeah.
Wow, I'm so smart.
Hello? Okay, am I loud now?
Yes,
hello,
better.
Hello? Okay. Is this better? Is it really?
Maybe turn it up a little bit if you can.
Hold on. Where's my shit? I'm all the way turned up on my OBS. Everyone, okay. What the fuck? Yeah, Logitech Yeti.
Oh, apparently somebody... Hi, Rhizome. It's a towel. Everyone's freaking out about this headpiece. It's a towel. I just showered. I was setting up my rig.
Oh, no. You're going to get canceled for cultural appropriation.
I know. It's just a fucking... It's not even a towel. It's actually a satin pillowcase that I use as a towel. Because it was cheaper than buying a satin. Just for my hair. See how wet it is? Or greasy. I never know.
One of those two. Okay, Lav, you're a tech savior because literally that was the issue. Now we're all together. You guys, let me know in the chat if it's still fucked up somehow. I want to know what's up with those tweets. Talk about it, girls. Go.
All right. Which ones?
The one where you said you're 28.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. So, you know how a lot of people say age is wisdom? Mm-hmm. I fucking hate that. I disagree so strongly. So a lot of people in this space, I think, will either look down on Lav or dismiss some of her like behaviors because they're like, she's young. And I, in the modern culture, like age used to mean wisdom when like we didn't have modern medicine and to live to 70 was a damn like miracle and impressive. Mm. Nowadays we have like oxygen and insulin and shit like that. Like, by the time you're 70, it usually just means you've got a shitload of plaque in your brain because of air pollution and you've been like sustained by like modern medicine. I really think that like wisdom now has to come from like experience. And to be honest, this is actually a problem in the space. Lav probably has more experience in her life than most 30-year-old streamers do. I don't know if you would agree with me on that, Lav, but my understanding is you come
from... maybe you trauma, come, yeah.
I mean, that's the thing. Trauma is experience to some extent. Like a lot of people have like basically lived in their basement for 30 years and made a streaming career out of it. Not all of them necessarily. And so when you say, because the part of the tweet that got me irritated was, I'm just 24, be nice to me. And in my mind, 24 isn't an excuse for responsibility for your statements. And I think it's totally okay to not be firm on your positions on stuff. I think that is super human. In fact, I respect it. I respect people not knowing firmly what they believe. The issue is when you communicate, you definitely don't sound like that, right? What we would call like, you don't communicate epistemic humility in any way when you communicate with people. And so when I said I'm 28, that was to basically point out like, you being under 30 isn't really an excuse for some of the responsibility people are putting on your shoulders for like how you've communicated and like the people that you've upset specifically.
I also think it was you posturing above me, which is fine.
Probably to some extent. Yeah, absolutely. I think that in general, I communicate my epistemic humility maybe a little bit above you. But to be honest, you told me to like not dismiss you over like things like your autism and stuff when we communicated. And so I'm not going to. But because of that, that means I am going to hold you responsible for the things that you said.
Sure. But I also, it was like a tweet where I was like, LOL guys, I don't have it all figured out yet. It was like me showing humility and being like, I don't have it all figured out.
Be nice to me.
Yes, but it was me being like, be nice to me in all caps. That was like very clearly like,
I'm not responsible for this, guys. I'm just young. And I'm saying, no.
Well, what am I? Wait, we're also what are we responsible? What am I responsible for? What have I done?
I would say,
that was harmful?
For example, so like a really big frustration I think that people have in this space with you, for example, is in general how you've spoken to and about sex workers. For example, the panel that I moderated, I think that you were like probably pretty harsh with Madame Genevieve and Kelly Jean. Based on your position. And then a lot of people felt some sort of way when you've moved back into doing a different style of sex work. I actually don't care either way. I think you get to live your life, but the issue is you do get to change your positions, but when you kind of shoot from the hip, but you come armed with a bazooka, right? You come in really hot and strong. You say things in a really intense way, often in a way that like hurts people's feelings. And so then if you change your position on something later, that's fine. But then some people basically are like looking for the responsibility, like being like, I was wrong. I'm really sorry, by the way, for how I spoke about these people, stuff like that.
I think in that tweet, what I was doing was being like, well, I wasn't taking, I still think that everything I said to Madame Genevieve was like accurate. But also when people are saying that, I talked to Brittany about this earlier, where like, I don't think that any of my criticism is made less valid by me rejoining sex work because I'm not rejoining it in the same way that I have criticized.
I'm not taking that stance.
So when I'm like, okay, when I'm trying to talk to my audience or all these people who are like, you know, Steven fans who were like, you fucking moved, or all these people on Cozy TV who were like, wanted me to be like, they're alt-right, like savior for like these women who like were pro whore bashing or whatever. I'm like, listen, I don't have everything figured out yet. Right. Mm-hmm. I'm like, I'm just doing whatever. I'm trying shit on. I'm new to the fucking space. I'm not formally educated like you. I'm not, you know, I don't have the years of debate practice that Steven has. I'm entering the space and I am like the least equipped out of everyone in this space, I think, except for maybe Sneeko, right? Like, I have experience, but other than that, I'm like very much like a toddler walking around on my feet and falling over, right?
But so you want to be taken seriously like an adult when you speak. And the issue
is we can't do both.
If you want if you want to be treated like a child with kid gloves, I can do that.
No, not like a child with kid gloves. Not like a child with kid gloves. I don't want to be treated like that. But I want to be treated as human.
Sure. Absolutely. And I see everyone at the margin of error. Like, I don't hate you. I just think that you've been irresponsible and a little bit hypocritical. And it's frustrating.
I don't think that I have been irresponsible or hypocritical.
Okay.
I think I was very aggressive with Madame Genevieve. Mm-hmm. But again, I also stand by every criticism I had of Madame Genevieve. And I don't think that I've done anything that's hypocritical to any of those things.
Okay, can I ask a question about the whole being held accountable thing or like being treated the same? I, out of respect for the people who've done work, I like in myself and like you, Lev, I think it would be weird to hold you accountable to my standard of myself because you wouldn't be able to meet the requirements. It'd be rude. Like, I couldn't meet the requirements of Kyla's education background. You can't meet the requirements of Destiny's experience with debating. So you can't be held to the same standard because you can't match up. How do you feel about that?
Like, I think everyone... Yeah, I think that everyone's doing their own thing, right? Like, I don't have the same sense of responsibility to get it right that you do, Kyla, because I'm like okay looking stupid. I'm like okay fumbling, because it means more to me that people are watching me fumble and still have genuine conversation than for me to be right.
Do you think that I approach everything just wanting to be right?
More so than I do, definitely.
How much content of mine do you actually consume? Which, in fairness, I don't expect you to consume any, by the way. Like, I don't expect you to.
Yeah, I don't think any.
Okay, that's super fair. I think if you would assume from my interactions that I just want to be right, I think you've basically...
Well, no, I don't want to cheapen it. I don't want to cheapen it to you only being right, but I think that you do... I mean, obviously, you bring up that, you know, you have, like, a degree in psychometrics. You bring up that you're, like, educated and that you, like, know a lot. And that
I actually very rarely bring that up. Typically, other people.
Okay, then why do you talk about your degree and like, what do you mean? Yes, you do to some extent, because you have to be taken seriously. I get why you do it. It makes sense to you, but that's not what I'm doing. My whole platform is like I'm messy.
I think you've read headlines. I think you've just read headlines about me. There's a couple of
times I've watched you talk to Max. Mm-hmm. I've watched you talk on Fresh and Fit. The way that you carry yourself, you're very much like, you know, I'm educated. I carry myself well. You said that when you were going over my video, you were like, oftentimes people don't treat you differently because of the way you look, but it's how you carry yourself. You obviously, that's a value of yours.
Yeah, for sure.
And that's fine.
I think I do carry myself in a way that's like a little bit more professional.
Yeah, so that people, but you do. You don't know that you do, but you do. No. And I'm telling you, that's literally what you're doing. That's why you're tweeting back and forth to me about my humility or what do you say, epistemic humility or whatever you said. I'm like, okay, why? Like, I'm messy. I'm emotional. I'm messy. I'm human. Okay. That's
my
thing.
Which is why we give you leeway, because you're young and learning, which is why you can't be held to the same standard.
Right. So what you're asking for, basically, in your tweet is you're basically saying, I have epistemic humility. I'm young, I'm naive, and I don't know everything, and I don't have all of the answers. I think that's based. The issue is that you say, so be nice to me. I don't think, because you don't have beliefs, that you're opted out of responsibility for saying things that, for example,
I didn't really say nasty, don't hold me responsible. I said be nice to me. I didn't say don't hold me responsible. If you've seen some of the vitriol that people have.
You think that I'm not being nice to you?
No, I'm not talking about you. The tweet was not to Kyla. The tweet was to the public. Have been so disgusting to me. I said, give me a fucking break. Be nice to me. Everyone deserves kindness. Sure. I don't think everyone deserves to be absolved. Sure. That's one of my values.
Sure.
I think that I deserve kindness while I'm figuring it out. I don't think that I need to be absolved of responsibility. I didn't say absolve me from responsibility. I'm nobody. I just said I'm figuring it out. Be nice to me. Understand me while I'm figuring it out.
Right. That's fair. I think everyone deserves some level of measure of kindness and grace. The issue is that, first of all, when you engage with people, you rarely offer that back. And also, when you speak with absolute authority and confidence, and you seem not to waver much in debates. And then you often, when shown to be wrong in a debate, you'll back out by saying, I'm young, I'm like this sort of thing, don't come at me. And so there's this pattern that you've established where essentially it seems like you create this pattern where you say a lot of things, you get a lot of people. And look, if you want to be a provocateur, have at her, right? People are going to feel some sort of way, and that's totally fine. But then you say, whoa, I don't want to get all this shit for being provocative. I just want to say what I'm thinking and feeling. And my argument would be, you don't get both. This is like my biggest contention with artists.
I want to get people thinking. I don't want to tell them where to go.
Okay,
I think that's what provocateur does. I like having hard conversations. I want people to toy with my ideas, but I don't want them to adopt them unless they work.
Do you think you were kind to Madame Genevieve? Do you think you've been kind to Cherry?
Cherry does not fucking deserve kindness from me.
Wait a second, did you just say everyone deserves kindness?
Yeah, at a fucking basis level, until she personally attacks me, absolutely no, she does not deserve kindness from me anymore.
Wait, then you
agree with me. She deserves understanding. I understand her. Mm-hmm. I understand her, but I do not have to be nice to her.
Wait, you're right. But that's the thing. You are someone's cherry. You are someone's cherry.
I've never personally attacked.
Girl, anyone. You called everyone name yesterday, girl. You were going ham. Girl, yes, you speak
Madame
like...
Genevieve. Absolutely.
I didn't personally attack girl. Genevieve.
You
cutthroat.
Yes, you did. Kelly Jean and Madame Genevieve.
What did I say?
You called them stupid. You called them bitch. You called them moronic, right? You called them lots of names.
Okay, fine. You got me.
Okay, but this is what I'm talking about, right? I'll say, this is what you're responsible for. And you'll go, no, I'm not. And then I'll be like, yes, you are.
No,
and
then
you'll be like,
no, I am.
Okay,
it.
You're right. I
no,
am.
I get it.
This is the issue. You don't get to be, no, I'm fucking not. And then also, teehee, ooh, woo, oopsies. It's, you don't
well,
you
get to. You proved me wrong.
Yeah, but then your
response
to that
is how would you like
me
to respond?
You'd be like, oh, fuck. You're right. I have been kind of mean. That is a bit of a like.
Well, I am doing that in my own way.
That is a behavior. Hold on. That is a behavior that flies in the face of my ethics. Fuck. Teehee, oops, I'm wrong is typically not a satisfactory answer for the people that you've hurt and upset and said nasty things to. I imagine, for example, Madame Genevieve doesn't feel super heartwarmed when you just say, I'm just young, like, hee-hee, oops, okay, I guess I was a little mean. I don't think that that means anything to the people that you've, like, spoken
a little different.
Nasty
I agree with you to some extent, but I do think it's a little different. I don't think that, I think that it was, like, one-on-one with me and Madame Genevieve, and we were having a conversation. It was a hard conversation.
It was on my panel that I hosted with
yes,
Kelly
yes.
Jean, and it wasn't one-on-one. It was actually
no, but I mean
both against you.
Sure, no, but I mean like it was like a face-to-face is what I meant, not 1v1. Whereas like Cherry did everything and said everything that she said like away from me, and then didn't want me to look at it, or just wanted to have like make personal attack after personal attack without seeking to understand me or even having a conversation. So if she's not going to give me an inch, if she's not going to give me an inch at all, she doesn't deserve fucking anything.
And that's fine. That's fine if you hold that ethic for yourself as well, which means when you are savage to people and nasty and mean, that means they're going to be mean right back at you. And if the ethic
to some
you
degree,
want to espouse, both are fine. Just be consistent with it.
Sure.
That's
and
why
I,
people are upset. And that's why I'm frustrated.
And I think to some degree, I get that, right? Like, I'm not saying none of you can tell me what I'm doing wrong. Obviously, people are like, she just loves the negative attention. I come on to Steven's streams knowing that people do not like me, knowing that people are going to have some really harsh fucking criticism. And I read the criticism, and I take what applies, and I really try to internalize it. And I think that it's whatever way they want to give it to me or whatever way they feel like they have to, whether or not it's super vitriolic or super constructive, I feel like I deserve it to some extent, right? Like, I'm not getting mad. It's just when it's the things that are like, you're a fucking whore, you're an attention-seeking, whatever, that I'm just like, okay.
Yeah, that's
this is
all
a lot.
Appropriate.
This is
Absolutely.
A lot. Be nice to me, right?
Absolutely. But
also,
what I would say is when you communicate, I'm young, I wish wash, people think that you're talking about the criticism about the sex work, which is people's biggest criticism. So then when you say, just be nice to me, people think you're basically saying, I know I fucked up, but I'm young. Like, ooh, woo, oops. Can you just be nice to me? And people are being like, you're still an adult. You still are in a public space. You still said these things. I would agree, for example. I don't think people should be attacking you for being like a whore or like any of these things. Obviously, I would denounce all of
be
that.
Be celebrating
and I've
for
never,
it.
And I've never, well, I would also never celebrate. I think that's a really, really bad thing that people are doing to you. I think some of the vitriol you get online is unfair. This is the criticism that anyone can get. There is vitriol that is deserved. There are criticisms that are warranted, and there are criticisms that are not. And I'm basically saying to you, I think I have a legitimate criticism here. I'm not trying to be mean, but I do have a concern with your conduct sometimes.
No, I think, yeah, I think that's perfectly fine. And I get how you saw that from, that's why I'm not like, I don't hate you. I'm not mad at you or anything. Like, I understand how you saw that from the tweet. The tweet to me, and this is like
well,
a
the
issue is
you said that I was virtue signaling and like in-group signaling and like
you were
appealing to Steven. I absolutely was not, because Steven disagrees with me on this point. Steven thinks age does matter for wisdom. I wholly disagree with him on this. I'm not in
no, but no, it's not in grouping. It's not like it's not virtue signaling, and it is in grouping signaling, or it was still like posturing yourself above me. Like, you didn't need to say anything, but you did. Why?
Sure. Because I think you're in a public space, and I'm going to hold you accountable at some point for the things that you're saying.
You could have messaged me. Why didn't you?
Because you were in a public space, and I wanted to have this discourse in a public
no, but
space.
You could have messaged me. Why didn't you? It's the public space doesn't fucking matter. You wanted other people to see it, because you think that everyone can see what I'm doing, so you want people to see what you're doing.
Absolutely. Because in a public space, when we share a similar sphere, when you've been attacking multiple people in my
sphere. So you want other people to see it. So you're in-group signaling. You're posturing yourself above me.
But that's not what you mean when you say in-group signaling, when you talk about me in feminism, when you allude to things about me being a pick-me and stuff like this. You're not just saying that I'm like, of course I'm in-group signaling because you're on Twitter. You're saying specifically that I'm being partisan and that I'm trying to get virtue signal points from my group. If I wanted virtue signal points, I would have
just said that that wasn't true.
No, I would have quote tweeted I'm 28, first and foremost. I just responded in the comments. A bigger virtue signal and a bigger push for popularity is going to be to quote tweet. I then responded to you.
You did quote tweet me later.
Later. I did quote tweet you later when I was absolutely and you wanted mortified posture. By your statement.
Yes, because you wanted to posture.
I will absolutely posture about you weaponizing somebody's mental illness every single day. Absolutely. That's far
You wanted to posture? Why couldn't you just have messaged me and been like, you should take this down?
Why would I do that?
Because if you really cared, you would have. If you really were that appalled by it.
No. That's not true. If I'm appalled by something happening in a public space with a mutual person who's in my orbit, of course I'm going to publicly denounce it.
It was like one little tweet though, and it was like you days said, before.
I'm so glad it was about Cherry, and you said I might have mental illness, but at least I don't have BPD. Mm-hmm. I spend a large portion of my channel trying to talk.
I stand
about
by it, Bridget.
And defending people with BPD because here's the thing: you're just talking about Cherry. Every one of my viewers with BPD reads that and goes, fuck, another person weaponizing BPD, because that's what BPD people get all the damn time. And yes, I have a problem with it, a big one. And I will very publicly make it clear that that's a problem.
Why you did it, and it makes sense to me. I just still find it annoying. I think both things can be true. But yeah, I get why you did it.
I'm not denouncing that you're annoyed. What I'm saying is absolutely I'm going public, and I wouldn't go and message you privately for a number of reasons. Number one, we're not close enough that it would feel right for me to message you privately and tone police you. Because a lot of times when people message you privately in a streamer interaction, it's to tone police. I don't want to tone police you. I want to hold you responsible for the shit you're saying in a public sphere. So that's how I engaged with it.
I think that you were right. Obviously, I shouldn't have said that. But yeah.
Oh, in case people are wondering, BPD is borderline, because I know there's a bunch of questions in the chat. Also, just a heads up, your mail notifications keep popping up. I haven't seen an email specifically, but I don't know if you want to shrink that or not. On your screen, Lav.
Oh.
Mine?
Where?
Yeah,
how?
Just on Lav's. Have your stream pulled up, and I just saw your mail. I just don't know your privacy standards for your stream, so I just wanted you to have the heads
Thank
up.
Thank you. I don't know how to get rid of that. Hopefully no one says
a game of
word.
Lav, I want to ask a question about something separate from this, but it connects, Avi. So, you know how you talk about your upbringing in your life and how you got into sex work really early? And sex work teaches you, because it's one specific industry, how to operate within that industry. And Kyla went through an industry that's a little bit more professional, and then I went through a multitude of industries, but none of them as professional, I think, as Kyla's. When we age and we go through these like bubbles and we have these experiences, it gives us tools. And what I'm seeing right now is that there is some like lack of tool, but also a difference in value. So Kyla shares a value I don't share, but then I wouldn't have tweeted what you tweeted. I think what you tweeted though, Lav, when you say like I think all the time, oh God, I might be borderline, but thank God I'm not X, right? I do think that, but I don't tweet it because of what Kyla just said. But I also think it, which is the honest truth. You know what I'm saying? So do you feel sometimes you say like inside thoughts out loud and that it ruins your reputation as a mature adult on the internet?
Yeah.
Okay. So how do we feel about that in terms of like us being like women who've been there or women who have been in industries and we're just trying to like give you advice if you want it? You don't have to take it, obviously. Or do you feel like it's all coming out as an attack and not advice? And then unsolicited advice is the worst. So like I'm open to that as well.
I think I use social media as like a diary. I don't know if I engage in the most, I don't engage professionally in social media, like at fucking all, obviously. So I think when I post something that like, I know, I've also tweeted slurs. So clearly I'm not like looking at like a, in like an optics way here.
Right.
Whereas like, obviously Kyla is, because she has a platform that she wants to protect, and she's like a figurehead for like her own little movement.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, like, I don't see myself as that person. I don't see myself as, like, a figurehead for anything. I'm just, like, I'm someone who's, like, here enjoying the space, right?
Totally.
So I don't feel like I have to push or peddle a value system to anyone. So I don't, in my brain, I know that there are consequences now in hindsight, right? Mm-hmm. Obviously. I'm not stupid. I know that tweeting something like that will make someone feel bad. But while I'm tweeting it, I'm not, like, I'm doing this for whatever. I'm just getting it out. Which, 100%. Like, isn't necessarily healthy. I don't think that, but I'm also, like, a Zoomer. That's sort of, like, how we engage with online at all. I made my platform on TikTok, 700,000 people, by just turning on my camera and saying whatever the fuck I wanted.
I love that. No, wait. Okay, so this is what's so curious. Did you see the conversation between Max and one of the psychologist or whatever he was, who was, like, very professional, and then he had a historian on who left, and then he had, okay. So this is what I mean when I say standard. So you're right now telling me, signaling to the world that you are not serious, that I should not take you seriously, that you are not here as a professional. And because of that, I give you leniency and leeway to be your crazy girl self, because I think that's beautiful. But that means I cannot hold you to my same standard, right? So when you see these different energies mixing together, the reason, like, professionals have a hard time with Max is because he's not a professional and he obviously throws tantrums. The reason there might be issues here is that Kyla's very serious about her work. I'm very serious about my work. I'm about to die on this hill of my work because I believe in it, right? What does that make you, or how does that make you think of it differently? Like, we're trying to say, like, girl, we know what you're doing, but we support your casuality, but it's kind of doesn't make sense then why you're here. Go ahead.
Sure. So, like, being taken seriously is, like, nice, right? Totally. But I come from the place where, like, if a homeless person wants to give me advice, I'm like, fuck, I'll apply it if it same applies, girl, right?
Same.
I don't care, like, degrees mean fucking nothing to me. Some of the dumbest people I've ever met have been fucking doctors.
Totally,
like,
true.
Like, none of this stuff, I'm really against, like, posturing professionalism.
For sure.
Or, like, code switching. Like, I'm really against it. I think that anyone who has something to say, there could be merit to what they have to say.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I'm thinking that everyone's going to look at me. Mm. Obviously, that's not true, though.
Right.
So then now I have to grapple with the fact that I'm kind of showing myself to be this person who's, like, kind of just here for jokes.
Yeah.
And then also, when I do say something serious, I just have to trust them to take me seriously. I understand the I understand the contradictory experience in that, obviously.
And I think we all experience it, by the way. I know Kyla. Yeah,
I think it's deeply human.
Right?
Yeah.
And, like, we all be different a little bit.
I'm super casual all the time in my stream as well. I fuck around. I'm not always, like, dead serious and stuff like that. The issue is basically in the public square, I view it as essentially, like, it seems to me like you want to battle and wrestle with ideas, which is based. And it seems like you also want to be taken seriously when you espouse these ideas. This is why you were, like, writing a research paper. This is why when you came to, like,
media.
Maybe.
There's no way for me to know that.
Right? When you and I chatted, you asked me to take you seriously.
Yeah.
And in this space, you often talk in a way like somebody who wants to be taken serious, like somebody who's saying, these ideas matter to me and I want you to understand. And to some extent, you want people, it seems like when you communicate, you're wanting to change people's minds a little bit, right? When you're talking about, like, sex work and the patriarchy and the impact that, like, even if you're doing the most ethical form of sex work, to some extent, it's still establishing this, like, didactic nature between, like, men and women as, like, women being sex objects, right? I think you're wanting people to take you seriously. That's why you came prepped with articles. That's why you cited researchers in the debate. And I thought that that was really cool. So, like, for you to now flip and say, well, now I don't want to be taken seriously. I can do both, but you can't. You're going to be held responsible when you're acting like an authority and talking in an authoritative way and trying to convince minds. If you just want to be like, I don't give a fuck and I don't want any responsibility, we can do that too, but that means nothing you say will be taken very seriously. And the issue is the reality is you have to pick between the two, particularly in your public engagements.
It won't.
If you don't want to, you have to deal with the fact that people will always say that you're being hypocritical and that they're going to say that you're not sticking to your own values and whatnot, and you are going to get a lot of hate online. Like, you have to take responsibility for that, and you don't get to say, I'm sorry, please just be nice. I'm just trying to figure it out. that's not the out.
Yeah, no, I get that. I think that there's this meme that's like, I'm not joking nor serious, but a secret third thing, and it is my whole life. I don't, like, I've just always kind of been this person. I don't know. It's because I'm so dreamy that I'm, like, definitely rooted in reality, but I'm also really, like, kind of up here. So, yeah, I think that I will just have to grapple with the hate, or, yeah, I think that that's probably what I'm going to end up doing, is just grappling with the hate. I see myself as, like, an entertainer with some poignant points, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I don't see you're patriarchy sex work. I'm still thinking about that to this day. I haven't landed on a side. It's, like, one of the more interesting arguments I've heard about sex work in a really long time. I think you should be proud of that. And I think if you want to do that, that's cool. Like, this is one of the frustrations I get, right? When people are engaging around you, is people act like you're stupid. Mm-hmm. People act like you're like you don't know anything, that you're unlearned. But it's like, you don't have the vocabulary of somebody who's just stupid, right? You what did you say? Something you said egoic fucking today about me. Like, egoic? Who the fuck? Yeah, egoic. Who the fuck knows what egoic means, right? So you're not stupid, right? You genuinely take ideas seriously and you care about them. I think all that's fucking based. I have no problem with that. The issue is that if you're gonna wrestle in the idea, like, landscape, it's a rough world and people are gonna be mean. And to be fair, people attacking you for being a woman, people attacking you for being a sex worker, people attacking your appearance, people making nasty comments and being vitriolic toward you, I denounce every one of them. I will never support them. I will always say it's wrong, right? But if you say some nasty shit about mental health, if you say some things that I think are a really big problem, I'm going to call you on it in the public sphere.
That makes
sense.
Unless
you're saying, I'm not doing this at all. I'm just here for shits and gigs. Don't worry about me. Then sure. But then, like, I'm never going to take you seriously in a debate. I'm never going to engage with seriously. Because I hate debating with people who, like, just never, ever take it seriously. Or you can kind of take the Brittany style where she's like, I don't take it seriously. I don't care who convinced, but I do like to talk about ideas. I can talk about ideas with you as well. But then, to some extent, I'm not going to be trying to move you, and you might not move me either.
What do you think, Lev? As, like, a person, like, when you look at your life, this is up to you, girly. What do you think will facilitate your joy the most? And it's okay not to have the answer, because, girl, it took me, like, 12 years on YouTube to figure out what I wanted to do. Because I want to discuss, I wish there was a panel we could do where we could get passionate and it didn't turn into someone has to win. But I don't know if that's possible on the internet, so I just do my thing like this. Like, this is not a debate. This is a discussion. And I love the energy so far. So, like, is that okay that there might not be a space for you in Destiny's world to do that? Like, is that the issue? It's like, he's a debate bro. He wants a debate.
Yes. But I'm like, that's why I'm like, I don't know if politics is, like, the place for me, but feminism is such, like, a political issue that I sort of just, like, I kind of zoomed in there. But I think that feminism can also be very philosophical, right? So
it's
think
deep,
that's,
I mean, it's all it is philosophy for the
most
part.
But, like, yeah, it's we've most politicized philosophy with feminism.
Of course. I think philosophy is inherently political. Like, you can't be talking about, like, the ethics of how to, like, live your life without to some extent talking about politics and to some extent talking about, like, sociopolitical. Like, mm-hmm. all of the humanities, unfortunately, like, blur into one another.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I think that, I don't know. I think what I have to do is be like, okay, I think I have to let the audience know when I'm, like, just or maxing.
Yes, yes. I think, if you put on a tweet and you're like, in my feelings, sometimes I'll message, like, people. I don't know if I've done this to Kyla yet, but I'll be like, yo, I'm really high. So just, like, okay, high thoughts. And then I'll give a really strong opinion high. And I want people to know I'm high so they know that I could get sober and be like, that was fucking dumb.
I need to preface with, like, this is a serious statement. Take me seriously now, or, like, let's just fuck around, like, fuck around the stream, whatever. I need to do that.
If you say something in the midst of your emotion that is really hurtful, you need to take responsibility and correct that, right?
But so that's, like, not fun. So
I
why
don't give
would
a fuck
I?
If it's fun. What do you mean? Of course you would. Because if I, for example, if I went online,
that was me being that was me being joking. Okay. Sorry.
Okay.
That was not me being serious. Like, Lav put out a tweet yesterday. Was that for the borderline comment? You said I shouldn't have done that. Was that for
the same?
I said,
Jesus fucking Christ, Lav, stop. Yeah,
no,
that was my tweet.
No, not that one. But the one Lav put out where she said, hey, I shouldn't have said something about someone's borderline. So did you try to hold yourself accountable, right?
Yeah, I said that was too far.
Yeah, you said you went too
far. So
it
was low blow.
Low blow, which it was. But, like, I also understand it's a petty thought. It happens in arguments. Now, here's the question. Does she have to hold herself accountable, Kyla?
Yes.
Why?
Because you are responsible for what you put out into the world.
How? Why? How much?
Because if I put out into the world something that like really harms somebody, like, and I cause meaningless suffering, and I know that, if I don't, if that disaligns with my values, if I, for example, if I said something about Lav that was really nasty, undercutting, and it like really hurt her as well, and it flies against all the face of my spouse's values, I think, right, I have a responsibility to myself and everyone else to apologize and take accountability, right? What you put into the world is fundamentally somewhat your responsibility. Like, you have to take care of it. You get to decide what you do with it, but it's yours. And you don't get to like hide away from your responsibility by using an excuse like, oh, like it was just like this, or it was just like that, right? So you say, well, I'm high, but I'm imagining if you said something really nasty about me while you were high, you'd probably also message me and apologize about it.
Oh, for sure, girl. But like, so, yeah. Okay, here's the thing though. That's because my values tell me that I want people to know the real me, and the real me is not somebody who, like, yes, she has petty moments and she can cut a bitch down in 2 seconds, but I try really hard not to evoke that part of me. So if I do, that's my bad. That's not aligned with my values. Lev, do your values consist of holding yourself accountable? In this way.
Yes. After I know that I've hurt someone, yes.
Oh, hurt someone, period? Or hurt somebody according to your values?
Hurt someone, period. I think that Cherry, first of all, comes off as someone who's, like, untouchable, right? Obviously, if she can dish it out, then she can take it. That's what I'm functioning off of. I'm like, okay, if she's dishing all this out to me, then she can fucking take it. So obviously I wasn't thinking of the collateral of like other people who I was. It was an emotional moment. I'm not above being dumb in an emotional moment. I wasn't thinking about other people who were gonna see that and whatever. But also, you know, I come from the place where I'm like, okay, maybe it's because I've been online for so long, but if someone says something mean about me and it's like one comment, I'm like, okay, what the fuck ever. Like, unless it's like concentrated evil, I'm not really worried about it.
I'm not this big, like, I have no problem with being mean, right? I'll be mean to people. I also take responsibility for that, which means that when people are like, wow, you're being a fucking bitch, I'm like, yes, right? I know that I am, right? I'm not saying that you have to just be nicey-nice and like protect people's feelings. I'm not saying any of this. I'm saying if you espouse values, you live by them. And so essentially, if you would have a problem with somebody saying something like that to you, and you would want to like, you'd be upset and wish that they hadn't, probably better not to do it to somebody else, right?
Yeah,
because all of our spouse values are great and cute and lovely until we are held accountable to them, right? That's where the virtue signaling gets yucky. This is why, for example, like Ms. Kiff and his crew got really like attacked over the whole situation because they espouse being like for victims and caring about women and like being more feministy, but then they literally gaslit a sexual assault victim for 1.5 years and ruined her career at the same time. And so it's like, you don't get to claim these values if you don't hold yourself accountable to them. And so it's like, if you think it's like meany and not nice and you don't like it when people say like nasty things about you online, you should probably be careful yourself or own both, right? You just have to pick and you have to be consistent. And if you don't hold yourself, if you say it's okay for me but not for thee, you're gonna get called a hypocrite because you're being a hypocrite.
Yeah, I guess that's true. I just, if Cherry or anyone wanted to bring up that I was like extremely anxious or agoraphobic, I mean, people have been like, yeah, she doesn't touch grass. I don't. Like, I'm agoraphobic. Like, I don't. I'd be in my house all day. So I'm like, okay.
Andy, like, it doesn't. You've started out young. You've been in a certain bubble. This is your first time in this sphere. So you're having a lot of news. Are you okay with being someone who might not know how to conduct herself in this sphere?
Yeah. I'm learning. Yeah, I acted, obviously, in the short 2 months that we've all known each other, I've acted pretty aggressively towards people. I'm not usually this aggressive. I'm usually not conflict avoidant, but definitely not this aggressive. It just so happens that, first of all, I think I was uncharacteristically vitriolic with Cherry. I don't think I was that way with Madame Genevieve. I think I called her stupid a couple times. But I was like, I wanted to destroy Cherry. I still want to destroy Cherry. I'm still in my anger era. So I think the Cherry thing is like its own separate thing. But with Madame Genevieve, like I even said on stream, like I shouldn't have gone as hard as I did. I think all my criticism is still extremely valid. I don't think I've been a hypocrite on any of like the criticism I was giving her. And I have apologized to her privately and publicly now multiple times, saying that, like, yeah, I shouldn't have gone that hard. I shouldn't have made it personal. So I think I do take accountability when I do, like, actually notice myself doing something, or when it's pointed out to me, like when you said, like, you know, you shouldn't have tweeted this. I don't have a problem taking accountability. I actually love to take accountability because it feels very human to me. Even when people were like when I was going off on Cherry, they were like, this is so spiteful. I was like, yeah, I fucking hate Cherry. Like, this is, yes, I'm being a bitch. I'm being spiteful. Like, yes, I am doing that. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the push is to like say that, like, I was like hiding that, because I made it like very clear. So I don't know.
You're allowed to hate her too. I don't know who she is, but you're allowed to hate anybody you want, girl. You know?
Yeah.
But that's the question. How we treat our enemies, right, is always the question. Sometimes people try to treat them even better to give themselves some sort of discipline. And I wonder if it's what we can figure out for you in terms of your pattern. Is it like the types of people? Because I don't know her, so I can't judge her. But it's
Capricorn woman.
I don't know what that means. I'm not that gay. I don't know what that means.
I'm just kidding.
But like, no, there's something honestly, here, right? Like, why are we able to be civil? What is it about them that brings out the worst in Lav? And what is it about you that is sensitive around whatever the energy is?
Well, I hate liars. That's the big thing. Me so too. I disliked Cherry. I hate liars and phonies. I'm like Holden Caulfield from Catcher in the Rye. But I hate. Listen, I didn't like Cherry before. At first, I was like, what the fuck, bitch? I was like, what, Cherry, come on. Why are you doing this to me? I was like, let's duke it out. It's like drama. Mm-hmm. And then she tried to do this whole thing with Max, and I was like, no, I hate you, I think.
Can I be honest about that? Just like caveat. I just feel like she really made a mental illness mistake.
Like, I know.
Like maybe it triggered.
No, and that's fine. Right? And that's fine. But then she doubled down on it.
But she apologized in the stream yesterday. No, she said, I think I messed up here. But she doubted herself because Max makes me doubt myself too. Like sometimes I think he's lying, but without meaning to. So I wonder if she was feeling the same energy from him. But she did admit in the stream yesterday that
she lied. She lied and said that she saw him. It's not a lie. She thinks it's
true.
Does that hold up in a court of law?
I don't think that matters.
She's like,
not a court of law. No, you're implying intention. Now we're looping back to the same disagreement we had yesterday on stream.
Okay, well then I'm not a professional about this. I have my own opinions, and I'm allowed to have my own personal opinions about how Cherry conducted herself, and I think it's disgusting.
That the criticism that she's a liar doesn't bear out well. You can feel that way, but what we're saying is the feelings that you're having are a little bit off here. Was there bad stuff?
She was careless. I will say she was careless.
I agree.
She was more than that. She was reckless, right?
Yeah.
She did a very, very bad thing. Yeah. She didn't think about the fact of like what these accusations would sound like.
But this is also, especially when it comes to like a sexual harassment, you know, whatever. It feels very dishonest to me. Even if you're not actively lying, it feels dishonest to be reckless. Because you're enjoying the in-grouping of trauma bonding with Stardust over it. You're laughing about him being antisocial. You're talking about how small his dick is. And then you're online and you're like, he made me feel uncomfortable. You're lying.
Wait.
Well, no. But, you don't know that's true. They might have actually been uncomfortable. Max does have a history of being exhibitionism. I think that they were wrong. They misread him because they're so angry with him. But in their worldview, they genuinely felt like what was happening. Unless you're going to convince me that Stardust and Cherry made it all up, they never felt he was doing that. They just 8D chest together a conspiracy to try to attack Max. So that's what you're implying when you're saying that they're lying.
No, what I am implying and what I think actually happened, because if you saw the stream, Cherry Foley is like trying to convince Stardust that it was like actually that he did it on purpose, which I think is even more gross. Because Stardust is like, I don't know, it made me feel weird. And then she had to double down because Cherry had already gone public with it. And then Stardust just got Stardust was stupid. But she got carried away in this thing that like Cherry was like, it's antisocial behavior. She had just come off of the Mr. Girl stream. She was angry, vitriolic about, you know, whatever. That seems, there is something to me, maybe that's the wrong word. It feels like dishonesty. It feels like recklessness. Recklessness feels like dishonesty. Yeah.
It's deeply yucky. Like what I'm seeing in you is like, it's yucky.
Or maybe it doesn't feel, this is the problem.
It's really wrong.
Because I think introspection and honesty are synonymous. So when I think that you're low in introspection, that reads as honest, dishonest to me.
No, these are two different things.
I know. I know. But I'm saying you are right. And I just realized that through understanding my personal dictionary.
Okay. Okay.
Fair, it's not dishonesty.
But can I ask a question? Because I don't know Terry, so I can't speak for her. But how is that different than what like Max has done to me or any of the other women he's done anything to? Like, he lies about me. He tells shit stories about me. He says the most bullshit things about me.
He did it to me.
And his version of apology is just like, it's half-assed. That's why I don't trust him. Because I don't think I think he secretly still thinks bad about me, which is fine. But that's why I can't trust him, because I'm not getting any genuine energy from him. But then again, I could be wrong and maybe I can't see him. So that's my fault. So instead of trying to be friends, I've just given us space. So why do you think like Max gets a pass but Cherry can't? Because I think that she probably just made a mistake, even if it feels like a lie, because it does feel like a lie, but so does Max. Yeah. But maybe they're just
he's lied about Brittany, he's lied about you, he's lied about me.
So maybe it's not a lie, maybe it's like a cognitive dissonance issue.
Right. But he would say he felt that way. It was how his emotions were feeling, right? But she felt that way too. And so the issue is if she's a liar, then Max was a liar all along too, or both are in their fifis.
Well, I also think that you need to weigh what is also at like risk though, because if you're a man and you're accused of sexual assault, that's on your record more than like a fucking conspiracy. Like,
I mean, I still have people trying to dox me to universities based on like certain claims that Max
were they your friends who then decided to accuse you of sexual harassment? That's like very different than this person who's like mostly a stranger to you online, who's like you're a Nazi cult leader.
I have a question. Is if you viewed my relationship with Steven, would you think that we're very close friends?
No.
Would you? Is Cherry and Max very close friends?
I think that Stardust and Max were closer.
Okay. And then are you and Steven close friends, Lav?
I would say we are on the friendlier side of friends.
Even though he called you a dumb bitch yesterday?
You're right. We're enemies. We're adversaries.
So what I'm trying to say is, even to our friends, sometimes we can be vitriolic. Maybe we can even tell lies about them. So I'm saying, like, I guess I want to see, because I don't know Cherry. So I really fucking, I don't know who this bitch is. Like, God bless her. I don't know who she is. So, like, I can't tell what she's doing. But it feels like, you know what I mean? I'm just trying to figure out your values. So if you treat people the same or if you treat them differently because of some reason.
Listen, I don't think it's that much different. I think this is all very personal to me.
That's fair.
Because of the way that I see myself in Max. I told this to you earlier. I see myself in Max. I saw nobody coming to his aid, even Steven, and he was like begging Steven to. And so, listen, it shouldn't have been me. It shouldn't have been me to push back on Cherry, and I acknowledge that because it looked worse than it did, obviously, because we already had beef, literally like the day before. It should have been Steven. And I was messaging him while we were talking. I was like, you need to denounce publicly that this was not accurate and that he's not a sexual assaulter. Because, I mean, literally, I mean, and it's not my responsibility to take care of Max, obviously. But Max is on stream crying. As an empathetic person, I'm like, okay, I'm going to fucking destroy this bitch. This bitch who I already don't like because she already sucks to me.
That's fair.
To me,
she already sucks. That's like the bias moving towards a direction. I love that for you. So I think that's fair. That's all fair. I guess I just, so that's
how is it different?
Right?
I don't know.
I just think Max is an adult who can stand up for himself. I don't think Steven or you have to. I think it's nice that you want to. But I think even in the conversation, like Max actually like handled that like above reproach. Like he handled that conversation.
He had to.
That doesn't matter. It
he
was
has
his
to,
fight.
But this is
and
his
he
industry.
Was, he wanted to navigate it.
As a streamer, he did well. As a person, he felt abandoned.
Okay, as a person, we've all felt abandoned. We're streamers. All of our people do this.
Okay, great.
To us.
But I don't see you guys as streamer. When we're talking,
right.
I'm not reading chat. I'm not thinking about how I'm seeing you guys as people. When I'm That's having fair. A conversation with Max, with Steven, I'm not thinking about how many people are watching this. I'm thinking
Max
I need
is.
To make sure that
Isn't
these
that funny?
People
But Lev, Max
that's,
is.
Sure,
he's thinking
sure.
about it.
But that's not my responsibility. That's not my value
but
system.
But that's what I'm saying. You're giving him an out for, but he's the one who's literally doing it all purposely, perfectly. Or he even said it in the stream yesterday. Let me take care of myself because I have to like brand myself appropriately. Like he is manipulating the audience to see his side, which is fine. That's what all streamers do. Right. But I'm saying it's funny that he's
not. I'll sacrifice myself. I don't give
but
a
why?
Fuck.
Why is Max not important
to you? But he doesn't want. He, no, he
it's
doesn't.
Not that he's,
he
it's not that it's him.
No, he didn't want you to.
Yeah, he
like,
asked you
to
stop.
Love, To love on Max best in that moment would be to honor his wishes about how the conversation went.
His wishes, maybe it was selfish.
Like, it sounds like sometimes we come maybe to people's defense and it's way more about us than other people.
And that could be fully true, but I could tell, maybe I'm going to do the Mr. Girl. I could tell how he was feeling.
I believe you. I believe you that he was feeling that way, but he had already, as an adult, told you, this is what I'm wanting in the conversation. If you wanted to caretake his emotions, then do it privately, because he already told you publicly how he wanted to handle it.
I am a very codependent person, and I like that about myself. So
wait. Codependence, toxic go though. Don't you want interdependent? Don't you want interdependent?
No, not codependent in that way. But like I think I really value my empathy, and I really value my caretaking role. So not necessarily codependency, but I really value the nurturing aspect of my personality that wants to help people when they're in a place like that.
Sure. Have you? That's great.
It wasn't for Max. It was for you.
Wait. That's great. Have you negotiated with Max about his consent, about whether or not he'd like that energy dynamic with you? Because that's a possibility, but you'd have to negotiate it, right? Because you can't mother people unconsensually. So, like, have you?
I don't think I was mothering him.
You just said you were trying to stand up for him.
Right. You were trying to stand up for him, protect him. Right.
Nurture. But, like,
you should negotiate a formal relationship with him so you can do that without breaking his consent. Because yesterday it was like pretty consent breaking, right? An accident. You didn't mean to do it.
Sure.
You know, but it kept happening because he kept asking you. So what do you think about that? Like, is that too BDSM? Am I projecting my BDSM negotiation skills onto people right now?
No, that sounds like a conversation that we probably should have. It makes me deeply uncomfortable, though.
Why?
Yeah. Because then if he says that he's uncomfortable with it, then I have to change something that is like very integral to my being.
Totally.
Which feels like wrong and uncomfortable to me. But I think that you're right that I should do that.
Yeah. But I feel that. That's why I hate to say it. Like, as much as I'd love to talk to everyone in the world, some people I'm not willing to sacrifice who I am to be able to have friendships with them. So I think that's fair. It's sad. It's a bummer. But so I feel you on that.
And probably your energy towards Cherry was also clouding that interaction, right? You have like a lot more heat in general about the situation, even though it's like Stardust and Cherry together. There's a lot more heat that you have for Cherry than you do for Stardust, which I think is fair based on, like, that's just human. But that's probably part of what was going on as well.
Like, I already 2 days before I made the claim that she was like reckless and manipulative and victimizing herself. And then literally a day later, I was like, holy shit. I was like, I was right. I was doing my victory lap. And then I was like, oh wait, this is very serious.
You were smiling, right? Like when people were going in on Cherry, like you were just like, yes. Right. So like there was multiple layers going on.
Yes.
All of them are deeply human. Right. I just want to make sure that we're like being honest about it and not like coping about like creating it to be something that it wasn't.
Totally. So I think, multiple things were true at once.
This part of the space is always so frustrating to me, because as much as I want people to like treat me like a person, I sometimes find like the best way to do that is to keep like a specific amount of safe space away from people, which is so counterintuitive to my desire to be close to people. So I feel like this is the hardest thing for me to cope with, is the idea that like, I like Kyla. I want to be closer to Kyla. What does that mean? Am I overpromising to Kyla? Like, I have to think about, like, I get anxiety over like, I'm so busy in my own life. I have such an inner circle that I take care of. I can't actually be like Kyla's 2 a.m. call, but God, I hope that we can negotiate a friendship where I can at least
talk
to her.
Which
we did.
Which was base.
Yeah. Where I can,
we're
like,
both very direct. So that worked out well.
Because I notice that even adults, we have a really hard time saying, I want to be friends with you, and not knowing what that means. And so we have expectations that we put on each other that is so unfair, but we don't even mean to do it. It's what we're all taught. So like, I'm excited about these conversations moving us in a direction where we can learn to be appropriate friends.
Yeah.
That's really interesting.
I have one last question for you, Lev. I don't want to derail. So if you wanted to respond to Brittany, I don't want to like take us in a new direction.
Oh, I was just, I had an anecdote. I think every friendship I've ever been in, I was like scooped up and taken for the ride. And I do not want to have conversations like that. I just want someone to accept me as I am and adopt me. I don't want to have to deal with like, you either like me or you don't, and you pick me. And if you don't, then I don't want to think about it.
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair.
That makes sense. I always had to chase friendships. I basically picked people and said, "You're going to be my friend now," and then I just made it
happen. Yeah, you are the person picked. Who saves people. Like
so, you
me.
Might say I'm a pick me, but I was never picked. I always chased. Banding off of that though, I feel like you and I need to talk a little bit more about feminism because I've heard like through the ether some of the things you say about me around feminism and stuff and appealing to men that I don't love. So I just want to like clarify maybe your worldview, maybe answer some questions that you have because I feel like maybe you're not fully understanding me and like my zeitgeist, my worldview.
I think I should be more responsible with my wording. I think having a conversation with Brittany, she sort of explained the same thing that I think you probably go through, that is like you just want to take a more egalitarian approach because feminism means something in the zeitgeist. And I think that I read that, even though you say it's not to be a pick me, I read that as like, oh, Jesus Christ, you're pandering to these men who don't want you to call yourself a feminist. That's a me thing. That's not a you thing. So I'm sorry for putting that into the public sphere. Because it's an emotional reaction.
Yeah, yeah. And I guess I run into this issue a lot where because I'm in the male spaces so much, I do talk a lot about men's mental health, but it makes me really sad when like women attack me specifically for being like a pick me and stuff like this. And this is just me being Fifi's, by the way. This is just all my feelings. No professionalism, as you would say. It makes me sad when I get attacked by women in this way specifically because most of my career, I spend talking about men's mental health and trying to tell men that women are worthwhile. And so when women attack me and call me a pick me, it's like when I went on Fresh and Fit, I mostly spent the time talking about facts and then throwing myself under the bus because I actually represent this golden ideal of women. And I try and I talk to them about how I am not it, like the one body count, the like super virgin, because that's me. Is not all it's cracked up to be. It usually comes from high levels of trauma and shame, right? And it leads to things like chronic vaginismus and never having orgasms and stuff like that. So it makes me sad when I see women, especially like women on like the left field and like feminists attack me in this way because I do so much fucking heavy lifting for women all the damn time. Yeah. And it makes me, and it's hard, right? Because then it makes me want to be black-pilled on women too. And so I have to like fight that, and I spend like a lot of time in my like private time especially trying to engage in like more feminine spaces so that I like remember that like women are worthwhile because that's what I'm advocating for. So yeah, I just want you to know like that's kind of my perspective. I don't want to throw women under the bus. I do actually dislike large elements of feminism. I was distinctly not a feminist though long before I was working with men. I actually became not a feminist in like my last year of university before I was doing work with anyone really.
Since I think I obviously the bias that is like, you know, obviously I call myself a feminist. And I think that you can be a feminist and be subversive from like this bigger cultural movement. So, but I understand if you don't want to take that on, right? It's not your responsibility to take on to change the name of feminism, right? That's like, that's my value system. Mm-hmm. But also with, what the fuck? Oh, sorry. I just got a weird notification, but. I'll be really honest with the pick me stuff. I am oftentimes called a pick me, and it is so easy when something is weaponized against you to weaponize it against other women.
Totally.
So I think that I did that to posture myself above you in a feminist sense. Because it's been done to me, which was not fair of me to do to you. Obviously, I have critique of, you know, everyone could be doing something a little better, right? Everyone could be.
You can levy valid critiques against me.
Yeah, I don't think, and I'm sorry that made you that made you feel bad. I think, listen, I'm dealing with the same internalized misogyny that we're all dealing with. So calling someone a pick me feels real good when you're a feminist.
It's true. And it's just interesting that I've never done the same to anyone. And yeah. I don't call myself a feminist, which isn't, just to say, it's fine. You are superior in the feminist realm because you care about the movement. You're part of it. You're also probably more learned on it than I am, which is fine. That's totally fine. And I'm okay with you being superior in that realm specifically. Like this idea that everyone needs to be equal. I just like, it just needs to be fair. Like we're not all equal, right? That's why there's doctors. That's why there's like specialists. That's why some people are superstar athletes. Some people are just better at debating, right? Steven is a savant at debating. Not so good at things like rock climbing. You know who's good at rock climbing? My husband.
We're talking about feelings. Yeah. That makes sense. I think that also pick-me-ism, deeply misogynistic.
It is. Deeply misogynistic. I've had multiple people tell me that the only reason I could possibly have the positions that I have is because I'm married to Nick, which basically says you're not a woman who thinks for yourself. You couldn't have come to these conclusions on your own. You're just there because a man wheeled you into it, which is so much more worse than what most conservatives say about me sometimes, because it's basically saying not only are you a woman, you're a woman who can't even think for herself. You're just one of those women. And that's like the worst type of insult I think anyone on the left can give a woman.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Yeah. You're right. I'm sorry.
But conservatives can call me promiscuous all day long. I'll fucking own it.
Pick me is such a... I've also been called a pick me, but I think it also... Like, there's something similar with all of our energies. I wanted to ask, did you guys grow up with brothers around men a lot?
I grew up... My brother is, like, the most... Like, 10 out of 10 gay. But yes... I was the masculine energy with my dad, actually. I hate it. Like, I was the sports person. I would help with the car. I worked on the ranch.
Nice. So, what about you, Lev?
I grew up completely alone, but when I started to make friends, all gay men.
So. Interesting. Yeah. And like, so I wonder, like, there's two types of girls one type of girl that gets mistaken for a pick me consistently. And it's almost like the straight presenting tomboy girl or girl who likes boy things. And yeah. I'm gay, but I'm straight presenting. Like, I'm not a lot of people know I'm gay, so I get it. Or, like, know that I'm into, it's fine. But, like, I grew up with a bunch of brothers, and I do a lot of masculine things. So I understand why people think I'm a pick me. But I also, a lot of my besties are all girls. I hang out with women all the time. I just told Lav earlier, Kyla, I was like, yesterday, I did not like male energy at all. I was, like, upset about it because of their reactions to Amaranth. All of them had, like, the same fucking response. I was like, okay, talk to me about business tomorrow. Talk to me about business tomorrow. Right now, I just need to like be sad for this possibly being true. I'm not even saying it's true. I'm saying the possibility that it's true makes me sad. And I needed to be in my feelings about it. But then I heard you all stream yesterday doubting Amaranth. And I was like, you know what? Peace and love. Tomorrow I'll doubt her. Today I have to be in my feelings about it. You know?
So just to be clear, I don't doubt Amaranth. I just don't know what else is going on. Yeah, right, I've never ever questioned that she's in an abusive situation.
Right,
it seems pretty coercive. I just have no idea if there's extra things going on.
Right, absolutely. So I think that like stereotype. That this is what I'm saying. If you know who you are in the anime, you'll know how people treat you and expect you to like act. And you know this is a sex worker, Lav. Like, it doesn't matter how you see yourself that day. The audience is going to tell you how they see you. You know, and like that's what the shitty part about our jobs. But man, why do we keep coming back to it? I guess we just like it. I love it. I love talking. I love this. Yeah. If I have to fight all the fucking trolls and all the fucking bad conversations for this, worth.
Totally. Yeah, yeah. I agree.
There's just something really nice. Intrude.
No, I love that. That was great.
Like your snack.
Full circle. Full circle. It went full circle. This convo. Is there anything else on anyone else's mind? Should we end the stream? Is there anything else to talk about? I feel really good. Am I the only one who's like super energetic? I can't tell whose spoons are depleting, but I feel great.
I'm like midway, probably because I came into the conversation midway. So I haven't come full circle. I've come like half circle. But true. Yeah, I'm good though. Like I'm not upsetty.
Yeah. I mean, I'm done for whatever. I don't want to overstay my welcome. I don't want to burden anyone.
Right now, you're my favorite burden.
Oh my God. Julie. You did the thing.
Yeah, I brought it full circle. There's something about everyone's energies lately. There's certain people that I look at because Lav, can I tell you, when I first saw you, I was like, I don't know about this girl. I don't know if I can trust her. I don't know. She seems, I don't know. She's talking to Max. I don't know. And then over time, like, I really like your energy. I think it's so fun, but I also think I just fully want to see what you do with your life. I think it's going to be very interesting.
Let's hope I make it past the year.
Oh, girl, stop. Every year I say that too. I'm like, another year not dead. Let's go.
Yeah. I'm like, I'm taking it day by fucking day.
I love that. So in your gut, like, you don't have to answer this because you probably have to, like, meditate on it. Do you have any idea moving forward how you already know you're going to change? Or no, you're like, give it, like, you like, feel free to meditate on it. But do you have an idea? Like, were you, when we were talking, did you, because I do this, like, did you think, like, okay, tomorrow I'm going to do this different. Or next week I'm going to try this differently. Or no, nothing like that yet.
I think I'm moving away from politics and moving more into feminism, but not like debating it, but more as like a philosophy.
Love it.
I really want to talk about like femininity in general. Ugh. I think that this can be political, but I'm going to be a doula, obviously.
That's amazing.
So like motherhood, femininity, learning about your own body, your own orgasms, the female sexuality is really important to me. That's what I'm going to do on my Patreon is like I'm going to review sex toys and then put out like reviews and also like
you should tutorials. Reach out to Adam and Eve and see if they'll sponsor you. They used to sponsor me back in the day. They pay good and they're really great. Mm-hmm.
Interesting. I should do that because I'm going to spend a lot of money.
Yeah.
So I think I'm going to pivot more into that space. And then obviously I think I'll hops in back into, you know, the Steven space for fun.
Yeah, of course.
But also I think that I'm just going to do, I'm carving out, I think I've had my introduction and I'm carving out my niche now.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
You know, what's really cool to me actually about what you're outlining. So, I actually try to be pretty honest that like, I'm not a complete person. I'm just really good at putting on a mask of being complete because in my family growing up, I was proof that my family wasn't broken, right? Because like my mom has had chronic severe depression. My dad has autism. My brother has severe ADHD and is gay in a Christian rural conservative household. And then I popped out and I was good at sports. I was really good at school. Nobody ever had to help me with homework. I just like did everything. So like I am like the ultimate golden child syndrome. So I'm really good at putting on this mask of being perfect and a really... So like one thing I did before going on Fresh and Fit that I think like had me at my best is I just decided to like leave the mask behind and be really brutally honest and like vulnerable, which is really, really hard for me. Especially because typically once I get vulnerable, I usually get attacked over that vulnerability as well, which makes me want to mask up again, but I have to stay mask off. And one thing that I know like in my own journey that's been really difficult is engaging in like the feminine space has always been really tricky for me. I've typically been more accepted in masculine dominant spaces. And I think my personality just naturally is a little bit more masculine. I tend to be just like much more dominant. I always just want to fucking fight people. I'm decently disagreeable, but I also have a high amount of feminine because I'm a counselor and I want to work with kids. And I'm super like everyone calls me their mom when they like get close to me. So I have that very nurturing element. I just kind of like hide it from everyone. And so one thing I like really like about you and I'm excited to see you grow in is, and something I think I can learn from you is I'm still trying to figure out how to be comfortable being healthily feminine. And I think this is actually one area where I think fourth wave feminism makes me really excited because I think it's finally tapping into this. Like third wave feminism felt like it kind of just tried to be like, we should just be men. And I was like, I already know how to do that. I don't want to be a man. Like I have too much toxic masculinity. And I think one thing that can be really, really good for women that I really try to speak a lot about is being like, being feminine is good. Our society doesn't value it as much as it should. And it's a really big problem, but it's a really good thing, right?
Cultural feminism.
If you think about like the people who make you just okay to like be you, it's typically people who are highly feminine, right? Mm-hmm. Like feminine people make you just feel like I can just exist and that's okay. And like, God, what is our culture desperate for? Our culture is desperate for people to look at you and say, you can just exist. You're not perfect. There's problems with you. All of that's true. But also I just see you and I'm okay with it. I think that's something that you can bring. Just don't fall into the trap of like the toxic femininity being like vitriolic and like nasty.
Yeah.
But so that's up to you. I don't want to tell you how to live your life. This is what I respect about you and like what I value about you most. Not that I'm trying to like, I don't want to, like, crush you with my expectations. I'm not saying, like, me from my femininity. I'm just saying...
Max would not like you complimenting me like this.
I think it's deeply valuable. Like, I think it's deeply, deeply valuable what you have the potential to bring to the space. I think, like, having feminine discourse and feminine, like, energy within, like, ideas that doesn't fall into toxic femininity, or even worse, a lot of feminine people just fall into toxic masculinity in the debate space, is really valuable. It's something I'm like constantly fighting against, is to try to be more feminine and less toxically masculine and not toxically feminine. And I think that that's something that it sounds like you're wanting to lean into more. And I think that that's really cool. And I respect you in that.
I think it's really interesting that you have, I have the opposite experience, where I have been traditionally feminine, high neuroticism, high nurturing propensity, like very much like very empathetic, maybe to a fault. And I've, entering this debate space, I have forced myself to be more masculine. And it's not playing out well. Like, I'm not a debater. I'm not good at debating. I don't like doing it. It I feel like, bad.
Yeah, it seems like the script for women right now of how to engage in masculine energy is typically toxic masculine energy. Like, yeah. Most women who are trying to like be more masculine, like when we teach women boundaries, like what is the boundaries I often like remember learning is like, tell men to just like fuck off. Don't be polite. And it's like, that's not boundaries. That's being an asshole. Like boundaries look like being like, hey, just so you know, I'm actually uncomfortable with this situation. Or being like, actually, like, you don't get to speak to me in that way. Or like, no, thank you. Right. Like, boundaries can be very soft and gentle. You just need to be firm. And the key part of a boundary is you stick to it. So if you say, I'm sorry, if you talk to me in this way, I'm going to have to leave. Like, part of that masculine energy is you fucking leave. Right. And that's where like women really struggle. And so like one thing that I'm trying to bring into the space is like showing women how to be masculine and as a woman in a healthy way. And I think that that's something I really love to do. Like, I love teaching boundaries classes and stuff, because I'm fucking, boundaries are my shit.
But can't relate.
Engaging in like healthy feminine is a really beautiful thing. I don't think you need to put on toxic masculinity to be valuable in this space.
It's hard though. It is hard though, because especially when you get like all these people who, these red pillars who, like you said, don't value femininity. They think that they do. They think that they do, but they're sublimating women to like femininity in their sexuality more so than like their femininity in being a nurturing mother, you know, this like empathetic, playful, collaborative, playful,
creative, totally. Of chaotic creature.
Totally. Yeah. Exactly. So like when I'm entering this space and I, you know, I come into it that way, and then I'm getting all these comments that are like, you fucking suck. Then I'm like, fuck, I'm internalizing everything. And I'm like, fuck, I need to be harder, which like, you know, it's fun to be, but ultimately like, it was me when I was talking to Cherry. I think that was pretty feminine though. I think I was having a feminine moment. Toxic femininity, but it was very feminine.
It was very feminine.
Yeah. But I think like in other conversation I've had with Steven, where I try to be like this logical, whatever, I'm just like, I'm not that side of the brain. Being logical, so cool. Need it. You need it. I'm very emotional.
And it's totally cool if you're trying to grow in that as well, right? Just own the fact, like just be a little bit more, I think like probably if you want optic advice, which I don't know. So just tell me to shut the fuck up if you want me to shut up.
I would like some.
Okay. You sure?
Yes. As a treat. Some optic advice as a treat.
Okay. I think in general, when you're in a space where you're like, I don't actually know what's going on. I think this is actually something that some of the best debaters do, which is the moment that they realize they're slightly out of their depth, they say it first and foremost. So they're like, I could be wrong, but, or they'll be like, it seems like you know a little bit more, but, and you always add those little caveats of like softness and like it's essentially an element. It's actually feminine energy. It's a little bit of like submissiveness.
Yeah, totally.
To some extent.
Totally.
Being like, I don't fully know this. And then you can state your position and people are going to attack you way less because you've already given the caveat of being like, I could be wrong, but this is my thoughts, right? I think that'll do. Basically, when you're like, I don't know what's going on, I don't know why people are getting this way, that probably those like few statements before your statement alone will probably do most of the heavy lifting for you.
But not all of it, right? Because I say that shit all the time and people still don't hear me when I say it. Half my podcast is, this is just for
me. But people have Brittany derangement syndrome. I don't know what's going on with Brittany.
That's true. That is true. They hate to see a woman winning.
I'm just saying, like, ultimately, I don't know. The only thing I can do is humanize everyone and every comment and say, okay, this is an interesting comment. I hate it. I hate it so much. I don't know what it means. It makes me want to fight them. I will not. Somebody said the other day that, like, Trisha Paytas doesn't deserve a happy ending. And I didn't even understand the idea that you could think somebody doesn't deserve a happy ending if they, like, go through a redemption arc. Like, my brain hated that comment. And so I I feel like when people say these things, I have to humanize them in order to humanize myself and remind myself that, like, okay, there must be a reason they feel this. And it might be stupid, but it's theirs. And I do think there's one thing I want to say, though, Kyla. Well, I think your personality is fine, left, so you'll be fine. I can imagine the listener hearing this, though, and saying, if I have to preface every sentence I make with, I could be wrong, I hear the feminist telling me that's like a weak thing to do, but I do the same thing, but my personality is so aggressive, it doesn't ever, I don't think, sound weak. But I could see the fear in an audience member hearing this thinking, well, how do I come off not passive, but still open to being wrong?
Oh, man, I think there's a couple of layers there. Number one, because it's more being submissive than it is being weak. Being submissive isn't bad. Our culture's just decided that it's weakness. It's not.
True.
Right? Any this is what I love getting red pills on when they talk about like the submissive woman. It's like, cool, you want every element of the Christian ideal woman and none of the responsibility of the Christian man. Which is like, if you're at like, submissiveness is supposed to be viewed as this thing of like beauty. Like, there's nothing more wonderful than talking to somebody who's like, I could be wrong, but this is what I think, because you already have such open playing fields. And to be honest, if you're the kind of person who's just going to attack that, you're kind of just being a piece of shit in my view. And so like, if I get attacked over that, I'm just like, oh, okay. I know that they're just like, kind of, they got their own shit basically. Yeah. I don't know. Anytime I've been interlocuting with somebody and they start with like, I could be wrong, I just never see it as weakness. I actually see like, it's like Brené Brown says, like strong back, soft front. And like, by like showing somebody your belly a little bit in a fight, it like shows a vulnerability and openness to like actually have good exchange. And I think that that's just like ultimate bravery. Like, this is where like one thing that I think we don't realize, that I've like thought a lot about like feminine and masculine energy, is feminine energy is like insanely tough. Like, you know who like will always pick themselves up and like give their kids
resilient. Yeah.
And yeah. Women are incredibly tough. Men are oftentimes, masculine energy is very strong in a lot of ways, but like feminine energy is deeply tough. And this is something that most people are going to try to argue and be like, that's masculine energy. But I think what happened is that like in the patriarchy, we like took a lot of these feminine things and then the good parts that we liked, we made them masculine. When it's like, not really. Like, when you look at like deep toughness, like somebody like literally sacrificing their body vulnerably for another, it's oftentimes feminine, like birth, and like you get imagery of like you'll get a lot of these images of like these creatures that are being vulnerable and deeply tough, right? So I don't know, I just don't think it's weakness, and I think people who see it as weakness
are dumb.
That just leads me to a whole other conversation where if they start attacking me, I'm like, why you're so weak, I'd be like, why the fuck would you think that's weak?
Yeah.
Isn't that good? Don't you want me to engage in epistemic humility? And then they're like, right? So I don't know. It's never been an issue for me to wiggle out of. Yeah.
When you said the strong backs, like soft front or whatever, like that quote, that's actually, I think, what it is. Because I will say, like, showing humility when you're strong in yourself makes people also respect you. But if you come, like, weak and passive, you're like, oh, I don't know if this is real, but like, it's like, that is like, now you don't even have a strong back. It's like, homie, say I am ignorant with a straight back, with your full chest. I'm not sure, someone help me understand. You know, it's like, it's so that's maybe a big part of it too. It's like the difference when you try to explain to a man how to like confidently approach a woman versus like fake confidence. So it really
like,
gets, yeah.
Like aggressiveness. Like, you want a guy to come confidently and assertively, but you don't want him to be aggressive typically. And that's a really, really fine line. Men have a lot of fine lines to navigate too. Women, unfortunately, we haven't been socialized in how to be assertive well. So we kind of have to like make the shit up as we go, and we're going to fuck up. And I have total grace for that. We just got to figure it out. And we got to make the social scripts. We got to teach young women how to be like assertive and engage in that, and have to teach men how to like know how to emotionally navigate the landscape. I'm not going to say like talk about their feelings, because I think that's not it, but men need to know like how to exist as an emotional creature, essentially. Yeah. Like what that looks like and means for them in a really deep way.
Did you guys see a tweet the other day on Twitter? My timeline's so weird. But I saw it, and it was like a girl and a guy talking, I think. And the girl goes, hey, do you have like a winter depression, or like, what do they call winter depression, guys? There's like a term.
Seasonal?
Seasonal depression. It's like coming up. He goes, yeah. She goes, how do you guys deal with it? He's like, football season, bro. That's why they do it in the winter. And I was like laughing at that idea. I don't even know if this is a real story, but I was thinking about that idea. Like, did men subconsciously put football in the winter so they wouldn't have to be depressed outwardly and they can do it through football? And then I was thinking about this, and I don't know if men operate that way, but I know women, at least the women I know, we think about these things like, winter's coming. Everyone get ready. Let's, like, I purposely use brighter colors during the winter. I get really warm. I like really tell my brothers, okay, guys, seasonal depression is around the corner. Let's make sure to avoid it if we can. Let's go. And it's like, how do we do that? How do we stay healthy during the winter? Because, girl, it snows here. And I get, the cold is not my friend. So I stay inside with the fireplace.
It's so cozy.
As long as I don't have to be in it. But, like, that's the thing. So I wonder if men do that too, if they preemptively prepare ahead of time, but they don't say it out loud. Like, it's football. But maybe they do it subconsciously. Anyways, just a thought I had.
It's football.
Who is the squirrel? Yeah, who's planning for the winter?
Exactly. Which is so funny.
That's why I think that every man needs a woman, or every masculine needs a feminine, because I my fiance sort of suffers a seasonal depression. But August 1st comes up, the whole house is decorated in Halloween, and then after Halloween the whole house is decorated in Happy Christmas. He doesn't even have time to think that he's unhappy because we're celebrating a holiday, and he doesn't even know that's what I'm doing, that I'm implanting it in him. But I am, and that's feminine energy.
It actually, my mom would do that when we were younger. My mom would preemptively think about, like, how my brothers would feel, my father or me, and she would try to, you know, actively move the kids around, go, hey, I know what my kids are like, I know what season they get sad, I know what, you know. But you have to really care and know about people to know these things. I think that's really beautiful.
Extremely beautiful. There we do not value mothers enough.
We don't know about and feminine. I mean, we do value mothers, and then we don't value mothers. Like, right. Exactly. We do this weird, like, romanticizing where, totally, like, mothers can never be wrong. Fuck. Working with children and their mothers is a fucking nightmare. Because sometimes a little bit romanticize mothers, where it's like, mother knows best. And it's like, motherfucker, I've been going to school for this for like 7 years. I promise you I know better. And they're like, but I know my child better. And I'm like, of course you do. But I can hear from you about who your child is and then make recommendations based on that. And they're like, no, fuck you. So... yeah, there's this duality of, like, we romanticize elements of motherhood that I feel like some are good and some are, like, neutral to negative. Yeah. And then we undervalue, like, some of the most important parts. Like, it's like somehow we missed it. And I think we do the same for men, right? I think we do the exact same for men and fatherhood. We overvalue some parts. Some parts are good. Some types are neutral.
100%. I'm ready for a nap, ladies.
You guys have been going for a long time.
Day for me, which is so funny. I'm trying to get better at my spoons, but man, once 3-4 o'clock rolls around, my body just goes, and we're done. And I'm like, blah.
Yeah.
You know,
that's
what I mean?
Yeah, me too.
Yeah.
You know what we don't do? We don't give mothers prestige.
That's what we don't do. Which is interesting. Like, it's not an honorary title.
Like, we love them, we value them, we have empathy for them, and we, like, care about them and, like, the nurturing kind of way. Like, we're like, we should put mothers and children, right? All this idea. But we don't give motherhood prestige, right? We don't, like, recognize it as an accomplishment necessarily.
Right.
Well, we should give mothers a title.
Well, the title, like, is mother, fucker.
Well, no, but like a PhD, like a mother PhD.
But to do that, we have to rate moms, right?
No, because
not all mothers are good. Mothers are good.
My mother would not have a PhD in motherhood.
And we don't want to have that conversation, right? We don't want to have that collective responsibility. Totally. Like, look, some moms are not good. They're fucked up, right?
Yeah.
And so, like, if you want to give women motherhood prestige, then we have to rate motherhood to some degree and say, like, which moms are good moms and which moms are bad moms. And it's like, our society is not ready for that. I think that that would be based, to be honest, but we're not ready for that. We're pretty open, like,
good eugenics dad, bad moment. Dad.
No. Like, we talk about a good father and a bad father all the time, pretty clearly. But, like, what is actually a bad mother?
A bad mother is neurotic, forces her daughter to be sexualized through her, forces her daughter to go into industries she doesn't want her to.
This sounds familiar.
Yeah, like, that's what, like there are toxic moms out there. Like, are they not?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. Okay. No, I think they exist. I don't know if our what I'm saying is I don't know if our society has a good script for what that looks like. Like, if I say a bad mom, if I say a bad dad, like, an archetype comes up typically. Yeah. Yeah. I don't know if a clear archetype comes up yet, because it feels like we're a little bit, we want to be careful about how much responsibility we, like, lay on moms. I think especially probably because of single mothers getting attacked so, like, brutally by, like, the right. But we're, like, very pensive about, like, responsibilities and criticisms that we have of, like, mothers and motherhood.
interesting. I want to say that's not my lived experience, but that's anecdotal. I feel like, but I had a mom who was good at pointing out, like, oh, that's a bad mom on TV. Like, in movies and shows, like, the moms were always, like, dead or evil in Disney movies. So I was, like, always knew the moms were bad. Because, like, the mom on Cinderella, that's a bad mom.
They'll usually say something like, but she's trying her best. And it's like, I don't give a fuck. Her best isn't enough. She's still failing. Because we don't say that about bad. We don't say that about bad dads. When we have a bad dad, nobody goes, but he's trying his best.
No, wait. This is a totally different experience. I'm having like a disconnect. But it's true. Because in my bubble, I don't have this. In my bubble, all I heard was criticisms about mothers. But also how great mothers and pure mothers are and great wholesome mothers are and how important mothers are. But like there were bad moms. And I always knew like the cheerleading moms, a lot of those moms are toxic as hell. I must say what I said. But maybe it's because moms don't beat their children. Moms manipulate and tell them their bodies are fat.
Well, that's an interesting thing. We don't have a good scheme of toxic femininity very well. Yeah, if I say toxic masculinity, we broadly know what that looks like. It's like violence, right? It's like domination. It's taking what's not yours, that sort of stuff. When I say toxic femininity, we're kind of like, eh, and then I'll be like enabling. But then when I start describing enabling, people are like, that just sounds like a compassionate person. And I'm like, no, enabling can be just as abusive as like dominating your child. I know this. I've seen kids that have been enabled into being destroyed.
Totally.
Like enabling is very bad. It's just, it's the Hansel and Gretel story. Like
100. Actually, I have partially enabling tendencies, I think. My brothers pointed it out all the time because I enable certain brothers, but I also look at it as like, what am I supposed to do? Like, let him be homeless? No. But then I put down hard boundaries and I give everyone time, like time limits. So I say, hey, in this month, you have to do this. In this month, we have to do this. Like that way I have a way to stay within my values, but sometimes it's difficult, but I've seen toxic enabling and I'm so scared of going there accidentally. Like I already have the tendency to be like, I'll help you. But that also makes me so good at my job because I judge people less.
Yeah.
So I make room
for the trade-off. It typically like some of the best traits, it's like some of the best skills of something can be twisted to be the worst of it, right?
Yeah.
So like the most like confident, assertive person, you tweak it just a little bit. Now they're a narcissistic tyrant, right?
Yeah,
totally. But confident, assertive leaders are some of the best leaders that we ever have, right? That take really good care of the people under them. You tweak it just a bit and now they're the biggest piece of shit on the planet.
Yeah. So that fine line, like that gray area is what I think brings on all the chaos in existence, which makes sense. Which is why some of us in our family stories have like toxicity for these 2 years and we got better this year and look, we got even better this year or maybe we got worse and went up and down. So I think that's the issue. And I think that's this conversation like makes me always love the sort of like diversity amongst people though, because I think we can all have stories about our mothers or fathers or we all have stories about our parents. But I am lucky enough that I really think my mom was a great mom. But man, she had a moment. And that's just how life went. Same with me. I think I'm really worried about that becoming a mother. I don't know if you guys are planning to have kids. But I know when I have a kid, I'm hoping that I minimize how much they might see me not being the best mother. Because I know it's going to happen, right? Like I'm a person. So I have feelings. I might get petty. What if my kid sees me ranting on a live stream one day and they think I'm talking about them or something? Oh my God.
Oh, geez, that's horrifying. Hopefully my fiance will take away my phone by the time that I have a child so I can't self-harm with it anymore. But my mom was addicted to meth, so I don't think I couldn't do much worse. I'll say that much. Much worse
Meth's
than that.
Hard.
Yeah, that's and hard. Her mom was a chronic toxic enabler. Like, bad. Yep. Like, bad.
Wait, was
alcoholic,
that the grandma that tried to help you?
Yeah.
Oh, do you think she was trying to make up for the ways that she raised your mom?
She constantly does. And she blames herself that my mom ended up the way that she did because my mom's pretty antisocial. And so it's like, she constantly blames because she's an incredible, amazing, non-judgmental, beautiful woman.
Oh, yeah.
But both of her kids are unhinged narcissists. And she and it's because she was like just too, they could do no wrong.
Yeah.
So they're like basically like unraised kids that had everything given to them. So it's like, it's crazy that someone so beautiful and empathetic and non-judgmental could have like, that could go wrong. Yeah. That could go wrong. So gravely wrong. And then give me trauma.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. That cycle. I don't know if I'm too forgiving, but I feel like I look at that cycle and I look at all the women and the men in my life and I'm like, you know what? Fuck it. We're doing pretty good. Shit, like I'm doing pretty good considering what just happened last generation.
Totally.
Fine, fuck it. Okay.
Totally.
Like, I'll take it. I'll take it as a win. And then hopefully when I have my babies, fingers crossed, I don't totally fuck it up. But I know, like, I always wonder, like, how am I going to fuck this up? Like, what am I going to do? But I'm trying not to overthink it so I don't want to put that anxiety on my kid.
This is why you offset, because I know that I'm absolutely going to fuck my kids up. I can try my hardest not to. And I think they'll be like, my mom's neurotic, but we love her. She does her best. That's why my husband is one. I picked the right person. Good. Like, at least they're going to have one fucking stable parent that is, like, normal and good. And I can just vibrate. And they'll be like, mom's mom, but dad was my rock, because he's going to be my rock, too. So that's good. That's what you got. You got to offset it.
Mm. I think my mom came from a really fucked up background as well. And I got a lot of struggles still with my mom, but she would always, she's super Christian, and she would always tell me, every day I pray that my ceiling becomes her floor. And I think, like, that's the best thing we could possibly do for our kids.
Oh, that's really,
you know,
sweet.
That like her, yeah, that like her at her best is like me at my worst, essentially. And that's essentially like, I'm decently like, you know, I come from a long line of very like alcoholics and abuse. And like my mom was like some of the more severe forms of abuse that I've also seen. And like, I'm kind of fucked up, you know, like I'm not perfect. You know, I kind of got emotionally parented by my dogs growing up, but, I'm a lot better than my parents were.
Yeah.
You know, my relationship is healthier than my parents is. And I guess the best I can hope for is that like my kids are even beyond that, the best I can hope for them. And then be aware of, the fact that like, I'm going to be fucked up. And so like areas where I'm going to maybe fail them, hopefully I can like know what those are and supply like other sources to like bolster them and just be really honest with my kids. Like there's nothing worse than like when you try to tell your parent like, hey, remember how you fucked me up? And they're like, but I did my best. And you're like,
holy shit.
Yeah. But it wasn't enough. I don't want to do that to my kids. I want them to come to me and be like, hey, you kind of fucked me up this way. And I'm going to be like, that's fair.
Yeah.
You know, that sucks. Like you can't do like the oopsie, right? You have to be like, that sucks.
It hurts my pride already. I just got hurt a little bit. I just like went for a minute. I imagined it and I was like, fuck. Like, it's going to hurt. It sucks. It's going
to
hurt my feelings.
I can't imagine having like a 22-year-old come to me and be like, look, like I know you tried your best, but like, it wasn't enough. Cause it's like, that's going to be crushing.
Ugh.
But I have to give my kids the freedom to like have that experience be true. Totally. And like, essentially, I have to take responsibility for the fact that like I'm doing the best I can and it's not going to be enough in some places. And that sucks. It just sucks. And I have to carry that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I'm going to overcorrect. I think I'm going to be like a coddling helicopter mom. I really worry. Yeah. I'm going to make like a Jeffrey Dahmer, because I'm going to be like so on like my kids. But.
Yeah, I'm just worried about being as critical as my parents are, because we are so I can't even explain to you, like, the yo-yoing of, like, I love you, but you're still not good enough that happens in my house is so consistent with all of us. I'm like, man, we got problems. But we figure it out. We laugh about it. At least we can talk about it out loud. But it is, like, something I worry about. I hope I'm not too critical of my children, because I'm so critical of myself.
Yeah.
And so I hope that I really just, like, spare them from that. But damn, it shows on my face, girls. I do not have a poker face. Mm-hmm. So fingers crossed. You know,
I hope we're all streaming when we're mothers.
Oh my god, I will be, girl. You're crazy. I cannot wait. I'm gonna have my kid right here. Like, I have to. And then once the kid's like 6 months old, that's it. No more internet, because I don't want people to know what it looks like. Like, I don't want people to know my kid. I just want to be able to be around my kid while I'm working. Like, I want to, have you guys seen those gyms where the moms can bring their kids and put them in a playpen in the middle, and so everyone can watch their kids while they work out?
Yeah.
I love environments like that, where like mothering and working and parenting and fathering works together. But that's just my little hope for the world. Maybe one day.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. That's fair. I've worked with like sex offenders for enough time that I probably would never have my children on the internet. Like, ever. Yeah. I don't know.
Wait, even as an infant, should I not even do it at all?
Oh, especially not as an infant.
Are they going to say weird things to me? Because I'll go crazy. I'll see Red Girl. I'll go hunt them down.
They won't say anything. They'll just, like, take images, usually.
Yeah.
Gross.
Yeah. Like, if you go on TikTok, there's, like, so nothing gnarly. I hate more. When I see, like, ooh, breastfeeding TikTok and the amount of favorites that it has, I'm like, this is it's just a booby and a baby, you know? This is weird.
Mm-mm. Yeah. Mm-mm. Perversion. Mm-mm.
Just to end us on a nice light.
Yeah, I know. Damn, yeah, Kyla, fuck. I'm like, well, that's a Debbie Downer. I just relived my whole next, like, well, I was like, never mind. I'm not putting my kid on the internet. Damn it, Kyla. Ruins everything. Fine. Ladies, yeah. Thank you so much for this convo. It was great.
Yes.
Thanks for having me on. I appreciate you letting me.
Thanks for getting on with your towel. I appreciate you, girl. That was dedication.
I know. I've had so many comments about what it is.
That is so cool. It's silk for your curls, I assume, to keep them healthy.
Yeah, to keep them healthy, and it does less breakage because I have like type 2 hair.
I'd love
that. I have white lady curls, so
I love that.
Delicate.
No, I wear my bonnets. I have my bonnets, but I never thought about the towel too. I'm so silly. I've been using just normal towels, but you're right.
I sleep on a satin pillowcase too.
You're smart. So smart. There's all these things I need to do. I need to get there. I will. My curls will appreciate it.
My IBS assassinated my hair, so I've just learned a ton about hair.
Really?
Yeah. When my IBS flares up, my hair falls out.
Yeah. Me too. Yeah. Good stuff. Have you tried rosemary oil? It's really good
on the scalp.
No.
Yes. It is incredible for hair growth.
Okay.
It's like, it changed my life. After I got after my PTSD heart episode, apparently when you have a near-death experience, your body goes in like hair wire. And I literally lost half of my hair, 50% of my hair a year ago. And it is, it's like almost completely back. And now I have like all these like tiny little hairs that are like, like weird stragglers, but you can tell that there's growth. It's 100% rosemary oil. There's like an Indian brand.
Okay.
But any rosemary oil, I think, does the exact same thing. But it is really good. It smells fucking weird, though.
I'm going to check it out, girl. I'm ready. You should. Let's go. I'm so close to Rogaine, girl. Let's go.
Oh, just to be clear, the satin is Nick's idea. He's now blowing up my DMs being like, this was all my idea. It wasn't his idea.
He has beautiful hair, too, doesn't he?
Nick is the aesthetics.
Yeah, that makes
voice
sense.
In the house.
Yeah, he seems beautiful. He's got swag. I can see it in his energy.
He does. I mean, he usually dresses me, you know. I mean, I dress myself, obviously. But
he
gives
you fashion tips? That's nice.
Oh, yeah.
That's nice. Absolutely. You got to have that.
Yeah.
All right, girls. I got to go eat. I got to go. Ooh.
Yes.
Yeah. Good all stream, right. though.
Yes.
Talk to you all soon. Stay in touch.
Bye-bye. Hey guys. Bye, Brittany. Thanks for bringing me on.
Of course. Bye, girl. I will not be right back. That is a fucking lie. Hold on. Oh, my God.